Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Welcome to the Co-optional Podcast on the 24th of March, 2016.
Hello.
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 Hello. Ba, ba, ba,
ba, ba. There we go.
Hello.
Best I've got.
Sorted.
Can't do any Hello. Better than that, I'm afraid.
I can die happy now.
It's always good, isn't it? Jesse, your office is looking a little bit more sensual than usual. What's going on here?
I'm at my home.
Indeed you are.
And I've never been happier. I have an apple because you guys spent 25 minutes talking about fucking apples before we started. So I got an apple. I'm doing great.
Good choice. You made a good choice.
Yeah, well done.
I have tea. I have some of that crazy British tea. I'm doing good in my life. Everything's fine.
There's nothing really crazy about that.
What?
What brand is the tea?
Twinings.
Twingings.
Do you say twingings? What?
Twingings.
Oh my! Twigs.
Oh. Nice cup of twinging.
Yeah,
cup of twingings.
Nothing worse than a bit of twinging. What?
The old tea wigs tea. It's delicious.
Tea wigs.
Yeah, I'm having a good time. I'm at home. I don't know what you can see.
We can see a couch, a terrible headset.
Yeah, you can see my headset. You can see a table. That's really it. It's my home.
Indeed it is. Our special guest for the show today, much in demand, certainly. I think one of the most requested guests we've ever had over the past few years. We finally got a hold of him because he's a busy man indeed. His name is Ashens. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Thank you very much.
It is a pleasure to have you. Some people, of course, may know you from eating things which you shouldn't be eating.
Yes, that's become a disturbing aspect of my career. I'm still not entirely sure how, and it'll probably kill me one day through poison. But other than that, recommended.
Either that, or it's going to be along the lines of you take a small amount of poison every day, just like the ancient kings of old, and you become resistant to all of this over time. So when the apocalypse does...
testers for the
basically,
king.
Yes. You know, when the apocalypse does arrive, Ashens and the cockroaches will survive.
That is the long game, absolutely. The short game is a food tester for Queen Elizabeth II.
Indeed.
It was a call, Mom.
Yeah, may her reign never end. At this rate, it probably never will. But hey, there you go. Impressive, really. She seems to have picked up the genes from her mother, who we did not expect to pass away at any point, actually, ever.
I still suspect she's around somewhere.
It's possible. She maybe was just tired of the public attention.
I think the world just isn't ready for her to come back.
No, I believe you're right. I think time needs to be taken. Speaking of time, somebody that did not have time to show up today was Dodger because she's a slacker. So we got her fiancé to replace her. Welcome to the show.
How come I don't get like a fancy introduction? Like, I'm technically a guest on this show.
Did you just say technically?
Am I just a bench warmer? Am I a bench warmer? Is that me? That's my role?
Get some twingings in here.
I mean, I didn't want to say it, Strip, but maybe. Like, you're becoming the Krendor of the show.
I'm accepting of this.
Okay, good.
You know, airtime.
It's really important to learn to live in the shadow of your more talented, more popular wife to be.
Yeah. I'm like that guy who has like an NBA like winner's ring, but like was on the bench the whole time. That's me.
I mean,
here's the thing.
That sounds like a good scam, honestly. Don't have to do anything, get a winner's ring. Wonderful.
Normally, I'd give stripping crap for that hat, but I can't because the Vans Warped Tour is back, baby. All my old bands from the 90s are back in the Warped Tour, and I'm so excited.
Oh, God.
Oh, my God. It's like I'm young again.
That's why I wore this hat.
Damn, I remember Warped. What was that, like, Linkin Park, Eminem, Limp Bizkit,
literally, they're just bringing back, like, all the 90s, like, Sum 41, Real Big Fish.
It literally is my sixth form playlist, is what that thing is.
Yup, I'm so excited. I'm like, yes, finally! So...
Oh, man, that's...
Now I feel ancient.
I'm wearing it because my hair is way too long now and it's just out of control.
Oh, look at my luxurious locks.
Oh,
that's terrible. Oh, God damn it.
You're wearing a hat too. What the fuck?
Yes, it's because I'm bald. Come on. Give me a break.
I mean, I feel like you rock it, though.
I mean, I try. I'd like to send it up on a rocket.
I can't make it out.
Yeah, it's my old esports team. Oh, that says Vans. This says Axiom Esports.
And very,
very, very small backwards letters. It's my old esports team that unfortunately has now shut down because we didn't win anything, but Yeah, never. It happens. Not a big deal.
We're British, that never stops us.
Indeed. You win some, you lose some. We lost some. More than some, actually.
We lost
quite a bit, actually, but you know.
We lost everything.
Consistently, but you know, it was good, you know. It was a good 3 years, you know. I made some friends. People say
that no one knows loss quite like Britain.
I mean, that is true. We are perpetual losers. We're very good at it.
Eddie the Eagle film out shortly.
Indeed. Oh dear, that's sad.
I just devoured this apple. Holy shit, I love apples. Get out of life, fucking apples.
Yes,
we've converted him. It didn't take long.
We got him, boys. Yeah,
it
didn't take long. He's now we snuck in some healthy things as he wasn't noticing, and now he's wonderful.
That's all it took.
Yeah, I had kale today. I mean, I didn't even know kale was real. Neither did Ashens, actually, if I recall correctly.
No, I genuinely didn't. I thought it was like a fictional vegetable made up to take the piss out of such things. But
yeah,
no.
Yeah. A South Park
kale
vegetable.
Kale is too damn bitter, man. Nothing should be that bitter and awful tasting.
Well, that's why you stick it in a smoothie. I put a cup of it in a smoothie along with a banana, 6 strawberries, an orange, a little bit of yogurt, and some other fruit whose name escapes me, and then just blended it up in the blend tech, and it's like, hey, great. Kale tastes of nothing, yet I get the benefit of it. That's cool. It's like, you know, I'm on the bench. Kale is on the bench and gets his NBA ring anyway. It's perfect.
What is kale supposed to do for you anyway? What is kale?
It's a leafy vegetable. It's supposed to have good stuff in it.
Exactly. No one knows. We just accept it.
Really knows.
It's good for you. We just accept it. We're like, yeah, no, it's good for you.
Yeah, we've been told.
The kale marketing board is behind all this.
I believe so. It's like benefits of kale. Apparently, it's got 3 grams of protein in it in one cup, which is quite a lot. 2.5 grams of fiber, a lot of vitamin A, C, and K, folate. And it has alpha-linolenic acid, which is an omega-3 fatty acid, apparently. So
I reckon it's just rancid lettuce that they couldn't get rid of, and they've repackaged and re-merchandised.
That is literally what it looks like. It is little more than that. Like,
and it gives you protein and diarrhea.
Together at last!
Well, I mean, it shouldn't be giving you that. If it's got a bunch of fiber in it, it shouldn't be giving you diarrhea. That's not how that works. But
it is. If you eat too much, it goes full circle.
Well, yes, but you wouldn't eat too much of it because it's awful. And the only time you'd ever have it is if you blended it into a smoothie and hid the taste. So it's good. It apparently may lower cholesterol. It's one of the world's best sources of vitamin K. I don't know what vitamin K is.
Isn't that the fictional one from The Simpsons?
I probably, yes. It's an important nutrient involved in blood clotting. It's apparently important if you bleed a lot. So,
what?
Yep.
Cool fact, until recently, no one was eating kale, and the only company that bought kale by the bucket load was Pizza Hut.
Yep.
And they would use it as a garnish for their salad bars. That was the only thing kale was used for before people discovered
used
decoratively. It was actually healthy. And
absolutely
started.
True.
Awesome.
It was just decoration on Pizza Hut salad bars. That was it.
Yep.
Oh, this lettuce is expensive.
Like,
garnish.
This stuff's better than the actual
salad bar. Why waste real lettuce, you know, if you've got a useless garnish that no one's going to eat? It's perfect.
That's genius. Brilliant.
Oh, my God. Well, it's a Corruptional podcast. The Corruptional Kale cast. We occasionally talk about video games. Oh, kale, genially. That was a pun that
kale
would. That's a pun that would have worked had I been better at it. I tried. Yeah, I get the silver medal. I tried. It's about the most quintessentially British thing there is. Oh yes. Well, outside of eating horrible things, Ashens, you do have the distinct displeasure of looking at rip-off consoles from other countries, and you also wrote this.
I certainly did.
You did.
What a book it is.
It's
so many words.
It does.
You've got to put it together in the right order or people get so pissed off.
It's got a surprising amount of words in it, considering it's quite heavy. I could hit someone with this right real easy.
That's the secondary use.
Yep.
Or primary use if you really hate someone.
Indeed. That is backwards on the camera, but you get the idea. It's called Terrible Old Games You've Probably Never Heard Of, and it is available on Amazon, and it's also on Kindle, I believe.
It is, but be wary of the Kindle version, for it is not as beautiful.
Because it's not in colour. Yes.
Exactly, and there's no formatting and stuff, so it's a little bit of a substandard experience. But it tells you all about games that are terrible, and they're old, and you've probably never heard of them. That's why it's called that.
Yeah, and I, so far, so good, because I don't think I have heard of any of these. And
that's what I like. There's nothing from the consoles. It's all weird old computers that were popular in Britain in the 80s. And yeah. So you won't find things like Atari 2600 ET and Super.
No, you got your Atari ST in there. You've got your actual microcomputer, exactly. Commodore 64, yep, Amstrad.
Atari, oh, fucking
Amstrad, man. The only game that I remember on the Amstrad that was any good, that was Aliens. And it was an interesting concept. Not well executed, but you played all six characters at once that all had their own screen, and you had to constantly manage all six of them, because if you weren't looking, one of them would get killed by a facehugger while you weren't seeing them on the screen.
That was a headache, that game. It really
yes.
was.
It was ridiculous. It was a game... It was actually the progenitor, I suppose, of Five Nights at Freddy's, if you think about it. It was actually about constantly watching those six kind of CCTV screens. And if you didn't watch one of them and were ready to shoot, when the facehugger came, your guy would get killed.
Yeah.
So if you think about it.
It wasn't an Amstrad version of PewDiePie in the corner.
And we can all be forever thankful of that. But it is interesting to see a sort of a weird progenitor of that genre like 25 years before it. It was effectively a first-person shooter, a very bad one. But you had yes. to manage all six characters simultaneously. The problem I had with it is I could never get my characters in the same room. They all started in different rooms, but the navigation was so terrible that I couldn't figure out. If someone got facehugged, you had a limited amount of time to get there and get the thing off them.
I don't think I ever did that.
No, I never managed it, because I could never find them in this giant facility that all looked exactly the same.
Well, that is the problem, especially with 80s games. You've got a big maze, very limited graphics, very limited memory to hold different tile sets. You're going to get lost constantly.
Yes, like being absolutely. In
the underground of somewhere you're not familiar with.
It came out in 1987 on the Amstrad CPC, and I managed to find a little bit of footage of it. We can put that on the screen. Oh, Jesus, that looks way worse than I remember. Okay. Yeah,
nostalgia specs are off.
Indeed, they had you see the heart rates. That's Ripley being eaten by an alien, by the looks of it. You got Ripley, Gorman, Hicks, Bishop, Vasquez, and Burke, and you've got to manage them all simultaneously. And you switch between their screens to see what's going on. That's awful. Wow. Yeah. Okay.
I played it on the Spectrum, which was similar but no color, so it was even more of a sort of drab and frightening experience.
Yeah, I mean, it was scary. I will give them that. If they were looking for a horror experience, they did manage to accomplish that, just not quite in the way that they thought they should, I think. That's not a good game. But yes, you can pick up your copy of Terrible Old Games you've probably never heard of over on Amazon or wherever the hell you would like, frankly. There you go.
Amazon's good, or you can get a upgraded, shinier copy from unbound.co.uk.
Yes, you were telling me about the shiny copy. My copy is a little shiny, but only in certain light. Apparently you have a copy over there.
Yeah, what's the shiny version?
Mm.
Ooh, look at that. Ooh. That's foil. That's a rare Pokemon, that is.
Oh, that's just wrapped. That's not even...
Hang on.
It's plastic.
I don't know. People doubting your book. Oh, God, he was right. No, he wasn't.
There you go, see?
Dust jacket on this one, look. Oh.
You've now immediately ruined the value of it by opening it, but...
Ooh. Oh, now he's increased the value because he licked it. There you go.
Yeah, there you go.
That doesn't normally increase the value of things. It usually has kind of the opposite effect.
If you get a few more subscribers, it will, trust me.
What is the lick limit? At what level of subscribers does it stop taking away value and start adding it when you lick something?
Well, I definitely you need your gold button first. I'm pretty sure of that. Once you've got your gold button, I think probably...
Mine's still in the post, you see.
Well, you need to wait for that to arrive. Once that arrives, once you have that level of recognition, then that's when it happens.
You have to selfie with it first.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And start licking things and then link like eBay accounts for the things you licked.
Gotcha. So it's selfie, eBay account, lick, sell.
Yes, in that order. Strictly that order.
I would say lick first. You never know when you're going to lose the ability to lick things. You could lose your tongue tomorrow, man.
That's pretty smart.
Yeah, I like that. That's planning ahead. Yeah.
The internet will always be here, and so will eBay, but your tongue could be gone tomorrow.
That sounds like a very specific and slightly worrying threat.
Mm. How many licks does it take to get to the center of your self-esteem?
I just love tongues.
I mean, okay.
Can't get enough of them. Got hooked on them and numb. Oh.
Oh my god. Welcome to Co-optional Podcast. We do occasionally talk about video games. Let's attempt to do just that. For the first 2 hours of the show, we usually talk about the games we've been playing this week. After that, we'll talk about the news, wrap up the releases, and there will be shameless plugging for our projects and channels the last 5 minutes of the show. Also, in the middle of the show, there is going to be a advertising spot for Audible, who is currently doing a trial sponsorship with us. So for a few minutes, we're going to try and sell you audiobooks, and we'll tell you the audiobooks that we have been listening to and why you should listen to them. But in the meantime,
We're going to get you, Sam. Yep. You don't need to read. Audible will read for you.
That's the wonderful thing. Even if you're as dumb and illiterate as Sam Strippin, Audible
I'm
is for you.
I'm the demographic. Why?
Congratulations. You are now the target audience. I don't necessarily think Audible will be happy. It's like, are you an illiterate idiot? Audible.com/cynical. There we go. But I'm going to say that anyway. Because to be honest, like, if you can't stand the heat, you should not be in our sponsorship kitchen, as Squarespace certainly knows. All right. Let us talk about games we've been playing this week. Our special guest, Ashens, why don't you kick us off? I'm sure you play things that are not awful sometimes. Let me hear a few of them.
I try. I just completely beat the Bloodborne DLC at last, getting ready and excited for Dark Souls 3. This is my Dark Souls 3 clapping.
Oh, really? That's how it goes.
Like a seal. Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, I love me some Souls. I'm slightly addicted to Star Realms on the iPad, which is a card game.
Yes, it is. I love that thing. I've got the physical edition as well. That's an absolutely fantastic game. Love playing this.
I think there's a Steam version, isn't there?
There is. Just got greenlit. It's out as of a couple of days ago. It's good, too. They also released their first expansion, I think.
There's several now. They're Crises and Gambits and all that stuff. Absolutely fantastic. Just one-on-one card game. No... buying cards or anything that governs you all start on an equal footing. Just sort of card game I love. I sit there on trains playing it for ages.
Yeah, it's a deck builder. And which is good because it's not like a CCG. Those who think, oh, it's like Hearthstone, I've got to buy cards. Nope. All of the cards are already there. The point is that you start off with a 10 card deck, which is awful, and you attempt to expand that deck by using your current deck to as currency to buy other cards from the board, and then you play those and you reshuffle every time you run out of cards, and you basically build your deck up from nothing into something good. And of course the other player is trying to do the same and trying to build a deck that counters your deck. It's like Dominion, only it has actual theme, which
spaceships Dominion. And that's it, actually. It's entirely spaceship-based.
And space stations. There's that, too.
That's true, yes. Space stations and weird alien worlds.
Indeed, yes. You can take control of worlds. It has four factions, one of which is literally called the Blob. Yes, the Blob is great because if you collect multiple Blob cards, they tend to synergize together. So if you have more than one, they do nasty extra damage and swarm. It's actually a very, very good game. It's available on Steam with cross-play, actually. I think you can play on Android as well as your iOS device with the same account, which is quite neat. Yeah.
No, cannot recommend that enough for a time killer. Nice short game as well. You don't have to like invest half an hour. It's only sort of 10 minutes and you're away.
Yep, I play it against the missus in the physical version, and she destroys me at it, actually, frequently. She's really quite good at it. I want to hear more about this Bloodborne, though, because you said you'd beat the DLC strip, and I think you also played quite a lot of that.
It's my game of the year, the DLC.
Yeah, I would tend to agree. My God, it's not that easy. No. Hello, I'm a man who does understatements. But, incredible fun and amazing soundtrack. Ludwig the Holy Blade being one of my favorite game themes ever now, I think.
Yeah, the soundtrack's incredible.
But that bloody Orphan of Koz at the end. Oh, my goodness.
That's the same response everybody makes.
It's unbelievable. If you haven't seen it in the game, imagine like an old man who's also a baby. Bear with me. It has a giant ossified placenta in its hand. And
that
it
looks
just
like bubble gum.
Yes, literally so. And sometimes we'll pull bubbles off it and attack you with it, which is even weirder now I've said it out loud. And it just screeches horrifyingly and attempts to tear you apart at horrifying speed.
And it's incredibly aggressive, and it's the hardest fight in Bloodborne. So you have to spend like 8 hours fighting a screaming man baby who throws bubbles at you.
It's exactly like
just
being in Glasgow.
Destroys you in every way. Breaks you down.
It was astonishing. It's one of those games where the more aggressive an enemy is, the harder it is to kill them. And it's so aggressive, it's frightening. I'm glad I did that. I even got all the, God, what are they called in place? Little trophy things. which I don't normally worry about, but I wanted to do it and be complete with it because I like the game. That was very good. Played SUPERHOT.
Yes, yes. I think we've all had a chance to play that one. It does not. No, you can definitely beat the campaign in about 2 hours, I would say. Maybe even quicker than that. But the real meat of the game, of course, is when all of the challenges unlock after that.
I've only just sort of scratched the surface of that, but I'm still enjoying it. Nice game mechanic, and that has been said a million times. And
What did it say? The most innovative shooter of something that it actually tells you to say in the game.
The game actually tries to get you to tell people that.
Yeah, it's definitely very sneaky like that. I think there's one thing that SUPERHOT really desperately needs right now, which is a level editor.
Oh, yes.
That
I'd like to see a level editor and third-person replays.
Yes, yeah, that's a good point. I was a little disappointed at the way they did the replays in that game. I thought, these replays are going to be incredible. That's the exact thing this game needs. Watch it back in real time. The problem is that because it uses exactly the same animations as it does in slow motion, those animations don't look quite as good in real time, I noticed. It's not a huge problem, but it would be nice if they were able to improve that for the playback, because it is very fun watching.
Such a fun thing with multiplayer with that game.
How would you do this game in multiplayer?
How would you even do
You would have, like, two teams, and then they would get, like, a second each to act, and then, like, it would freeze, and then the other team would get, like...
What?
That sounds more like Frozen Synapse or something.
I was going to say, that's the exact game I was going to point out.
Five frames, then they'd get five frames kind of thing.
That sounds actually terrible, but I don't know if I'd really enjoy that. But, I mean, if you do want a game like that, Frozen Synapse is exactly that game. And it's kind of wonderful. It's basically Rainbow Six mixed with SUPERHOT, I think is probably the best way to describe it. And by Rainbow Six, I mean the old school Rainbow Six, not the new one. Although the new one is pretty good nonetheless. It's just not the same game. It's cool. We've had a lot of good games come out this year already, I noticed.
Yeah, definitely.
I've just started Shadowrun Hong Kong, which has had a very strong start.
Yeah, that's good.
I'm not that far into it to sort of judge it yet. I really like the first two they did. So, lucky at a turn-based strategy.
Yeah, definitely. The first one was a little... It seemed a little underdone, but it was still good. And then when they brought out Dragonfall, I believe it was his name, that was like, okay, this is the game it should have been in the first place. This is exactly what I was looking for. We got the really stylized cyberpunk. I love the aesthetic of that game. It's neon all over. And the combat's good. You know, tactical. I like it. And the dialogue system is really awesome because, you know, you go in and there's an orc over there, but he's wearing, like, a VR headset. And he's like, hi, welcome to my club. I'm like, this is great. I want to be in your club right now.
Very strong writing, good characters. Just really good all round, really. Feels like the sort of way we thought games would go in 1984. Because we had limited imaginations. But, yeah, really enjoying it.
It's definitely a throwback in terms of its design, but it feels like it's been brought up to date. There aren't all that many games being made with the old school kind of Black Isle or, you know, esque style of doing things, but the ones that have come out recently, mostly thanks to Kickstarter, have actually all been good. You know, Pillars, Wasteland 2, those are good. Shadowrun, great. We've still got Tides of Numenera on the way, coming soon, I believe. I think that's in beta right now.
Yep.
It's a new Planescape game.
Oh.
I guess it would be called Torment, actually, not Planescape. But yeah, it's the new Torment game. So it's same guys, same writers. They raised a bunch of money to do it. And I have high hopes.
Totally passed me by somehow.
Yeah, it's been flying a bit under the radar, I think, probably because they haven't released a huge amount of assets for it yet, whereas they were showing a lot of Pillars of Eternity off. But this is their next game, and I am quite excited. I will never have the time to beat it, but you know what? I'm okay with that.
With the sprawling RPGs, isn't it?
I never beat them. I never have the time, you know. Unless it's like a Mass Effect game, and really those are only about 20 hours long anyway. I can handle that, but as soon as one comes along and says, we have 100 hours of gameplay, it's like, well, I don't have 100 hours of gameplay, so can't really do much about that. But I am happy that it exists. That's always good.
Yep, I agree with this principle.
Yep.
And that's it for me on games, I think.
All right, fair enough. That's a good selection. If you're going to spend your time on them, that is a good set of games to play.
There's nothing worse when you don't have much time picking something shit and playing it.
Yes, indeed. As Jesse found out because he's now turned against our Lord and Savior Clash Royale, it turns out.
Sinner.
Sinner. Heretic.
Sure.
Cast him out.
I have no problem. I'm doing great, guys. It's good on the other side. Come join me.
Nope.
Twin Jings tease over here. It's
great. I was close to joining you, but then I'm back up to like 1400 now.
Yeah, he's been playing it for the last 20 minutes. Like,
I dropped 300 rating this morning, and I was on full tilt, and I was like pulling my hair out and just furiously playing again, trying to like claw those points back. And then TB had to lecture me, and I finally.
Well, that's admittedly that's one of the good things about the game is even if you go on a massive losing streak, you can get those points back instantly. It's not that hard to get them back.
Shame.
So you just have to get over the fact that you lost a bunch.
Shame.
Well, that might be the greatest thing ever. That's it. Yeah, it is not hard to get it back. The weird thing about it is, and we confirmed with the devs that it is trophies only for matchmaking. Although the problem that you mentioned is still a real thing, that if at some point some people might have low trophies but high level cards. And usually it doesn't take them long to get out of that area because they're going to be wrecking you. But if you run into them, it sucks to run into them.
Yeah.
But you do get those levels back. And the weird thing about it is the way that the game is balanced. It means that you're going to eventually find the area that your cards are suited to. And you're going to be kind of stuck there. But eventually you're going to slowly move up because by acquiring cards, you are upgrading cards and you become more powerful. So the pay-to-win aspect that is there is a very temporary thing. And if you pay to win, you end up in a higher bracket, sure, but you end up in a higher bracket against other people who are also in a higher bracket and also have that level of cards. Or worse still, have that level of cards and are better than you because they didn't pay to win like bastards. So then they just slap you about. And I'm okay with that. I actually hit 2.7k trophies today, and it's getting really crazy.
It's disgusting.
It's insane. I mean, I've had a 350 win so far, I think. And I'm just like, they just nerfed a bunch of stuff in that game. And what's weird is that I thought, okay, they've nerfed this stuff. Now people aren't going to use it. No.
What did they nerf?
Tesla, Prince, Crossbow, a few other things. And then they buffed Royal Giants, Regular Giants, and a few other things. And I thought, you know what? They're not going to use these things anymore. No, actually, now more people are using Prince. You want to know why? Because we don't tech against it anymore. Because we didn't think it was going to be in their deck. So they put Prince in there because they know I wasn't going to counter Prince. So, yeah, screw that meta. Now I've got to put stuff back in my deck again that deals with Prince.
Great game.
Yeah, I love awesome it. Game. I play it every day. Play it every day. It's good.
I play it while pooping.
Yeah, it's an ideal toilet game. It lasts just long enough.
Yeah.
You know? And if you're having a bad day, two games.
If you had too much fiber, three.
Yeah, three games.
Eat all that kale?
Well, actually, if you had too little fiber, three.
Yeah, that's a fair point. That's how constipation works, ladies and gentlemen. There you go.
Shame.
Oh, dear.
Is that a medical thing now? The doctor will say to you, so Clash Royale, how many games?
Yeah, how many? It's like...
Four. I'm afraid, doctor.
Oh, okay. I'm going to prescribe you some...
I can't.
I'm going to prescribe you some X-lax and make sure you eat plenty of asparagus and talk to me in a week, you know? Oh, my. Yes. So, yeah, Clash Royale still going pretty well for most of us anyway. Most of us. Jesse, what else have you been playing this week then?
I was about to say, I'm down to no games on my phone. I've removed everything.
Okay.
So I can focus on like work stuff rather than sitting on a toilet for 25 minutes.
Just want to point out his job is literally video games.
Yeah, no, I'm aware. I'm aware. I've removed the only thing I have on my phone, literally the only thing that isn't like apps for work is this little baby right here. I love you. Oh, BB-8. And that's it. That's all I have.
Can you explain how BB-8 helps you do your day-to-day?
It doesn't, but I turn him on and let him go on auto, and he walks around or rolls around my apartment and goes boop, boop, and hits walls and stuff, and I'm like, I love you, BB, and that's literally it. He does nothing to help. So
useless.
That's all that matters to me.
Useless.
But you don't have to pay it, so...
Yeah, what's that?
No, I, this week, played a ludicrous amount of Master of Orion.
Yes!
It is solidly okay. There's a lot they need to work on,
yes.
But I played that thing like I must have gone through maybe eight full campaigns.
Solidly okay. So played about 80 hours of it. It's like, yeah. So the quizzical look on Ashen's face is because that is an old school game, but this is the remake of it.
I was going to say I wasn't aware they were remaking. Yeah.
Yes. And surprisingly, it's not awful. It's in early access right now.
All the voice actors are like famous sci-fi actors.
And they're good. They're really good. You've got Q is in there. Basically half of them are from Star Trek.
Is in there. Yeah.
Oh. Which now I'm trying to think of Q's actor's name. John DeLancey?
John DeLancey.
Yeah. 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 He's the human. He's like, I'm the human president.
Solidly okay.
It's a solid, I want it just for that.
It's actually great. There's a Klingon space bear. I'll tell you that, or space hippopotamus or something. The Bulrathi, I think, have a very Russian accent, and I'm pretty sure that might be General Martok. I can't be certain.
They made a video, and when you see the video, you realize, like, holy shit, like, Mark Hamill's in this thing? Like, all these amazing voice actors in this game, you're like, they went all out for this, which makes that part of the game awesome. When you, like, talk to the different people in the community, that's cool. I think the tech tree and the skilling up and all that stuff is really fun. It's kind of what I like, is just sitting there and making my civilization way more advanced than everyone else. So by the time we finally meet, I'm like, hello. But the combat is so lacking in every way right now. It is. I just put it on like, hey, go. I just auto it every time because there's no reason to do it.
I disagree to some extent. I think it has potential that... The problem with Master Orion with combat has been every single game has had some issue with combat. Master Orion 2, being the one that people regard as the best, was good for a while and it was turn-based on a grid. The problem is that towards the end of the game, when you had ludicrous numbers of ships, the combat took forever and you could only move one ship at a time. Master of Orion 3 solved this problem by going real-time, except in doing so, they literally removed every element of strategy from it. So it was like, it was literally watching blips fight other blips. It was shitty. This time around, they said, okay, we still want to go real-time, but we want to make it more tactical. So you can individually move ships, you can individually maneuver them, they have arcs of fire, and they have activatable abilities, and all that kind of thing. Problem in my eyes, and we'll see if Jesse agrees with this, is the combat's over too fucking fast, and there's no point in being tactical because it's literally just smash the fleets together and see who wins.
That's a really great example of that is if TB had a fleet and he attacked one of my home planets, if I have some defense structures around my planets, before my ships even get to his, they'll already be firing on his ships. They might be dead before I can even do anything. Like, it's so quick. The combat's so quick that rather than go through the process of setting up everything, I just auto-resolve. Because it's like, all right, well, I'm going to win so easily. Okay, keep going. Auto-resolve. Yeah, it's almost like it's unnecessary at certain points of the game. You're just like, why am I fighting you? When pirates attack me for the first 100 turns, why? Why show those fights? Because they always lose. I've never lost to a pirate once, even at the hardest difficulties. I'm like, why are they here? They're
the worst.
I lost
once. They caught me off guard with an upgrade at one point because like I can kill pirates easy. I'll just send my worst destroyer. It's just like, this is the destroyer that has holes in it. This destroyer should have been mothballed 20 years ago. This destroyer, it doesn't even have a crew. It's got interns. It's like nothing but that. It fires marshmallows at most. And I thought, you know what? This has been doing fine. And then it just got blown to pieces. And then one of my planets got nuclear bombs dropped on it because I didn't properly defend it. The thing about the combat is that I think that if you auto-resolve too much in a 4X game, then you fail to develop a compelling combat engine. And yeah, have it as an exam, have it as an option, sure. Yeah, I know a lot of people don't really care about the combat in a 4X game. They're more concerned about the management, and the empire building, and the economics, and all that kind of thing, which is great. But I like fighting, because I like fighting with things that I built, and in that game you can build ships and I can design ships and I want to see my ships fight. But you are right, the way that they can fix it I think is by just tripling the HP of everything, just making everything tougher, because the longer the fights last, the more maneuvering matters, because there's things like asteroids. You can, if someone fires torpedoes at you, you can maneuver behind an asteroid field and the torpedoes will detonate in the asteroid field. You know, if you figured out, oh god, this ship has a really great broadside, you can figure out a way to get behind it, and then you can fight from there. And if it's got a slow turning speed, that's where it's cool. But because the fights are over so quickly, you can't do any of that. So if they fix that, it'll be pretty good, I think.
I'm kind of tempted to try that now, but I think it's one of those things I'll get sucked into and never do any work ever
again.
That was me
this week.
Yeah. Yeah, he had a reflex moment where he's deleted all of his games off his phone.
Yeah, I loved it. I had a lot of fun playing it, but it's one of those things where it just hit me this week. That's a game that I was just got into it. I don't know why. Looking at it objectively, it's just okay. It's not terrific, but for some reason I sat there and played it for hours and just kept playing it. So,
it's the one more turn syndrome, man. It's happened for decades now. Sid Meier is a time vampire. He's been that's why he's never going to die. That guy's going to live forever because he's been slowly sucking the life force out of his millions of players over the last two decades. And Master of Orion is like that. What I will say is it is still early access. There's still a lot of shit to be done. Like, it doesn't even have a spying system in yet, and there's half the races aren't in. The races are not very diverse as of yet. Like, you can play the bird person or the giant cat, but they're so similar to each other outside of the aesthetic that it doesn't matter. So they need to fix that, because that's a big deal. But it's got potential. Like, I wouldn't buy it now, because there's no benefit to buying it now. Buy it when it's done. You know, because then you'll enjoy the whole thing. The problem I've had, I've played 20 hours of it, and I'm like, oh, well, am I going to enjoy this less now when it comes out? Probably, yeah.
That's a big problem I have with early access stuff in general. If it's something I'm really keen on, I don't really want to play a beta because I'm going to be sick of it by the time the, you know, full version comes out.
Yeah, I've avoided almost all of them with the exception of Darkest Dungeon. I could not quite avoid that in the early access because it was that damn good. But I will say, even though I enjoyed it on launch, the fact that I played it in early access reduced the amount of time that I wanted to play it on launch. I think early access is a self-sabotaging move in many ways. But as a business standpoint, hell, if you can sell a million copies of your alpha before you even have anything in it, good on you. Good for you.
Right. Yeah, can't argue with that.
Yep, it's money. And in today's indie market, that is not a guarantee. Not in the slightest. But it looks like Master of Orion, hopefully, is going to be good. I would just recommend waiting for it to release, personally. Anything else you've been playing this week, Jesse?
I finished up Oxenfree. Mm. And that game is awesome, but only when you beat it do you realize what the devs have created, which is essentially a real-life augmented or alternate reality game that is bonkers, like just bonkers. So the game is based off radio waves and contacting the dead. Like, that's the premise of the game. So you're a bunch of kids on an island, and it's sort of like a semi-horror game, but not really like super scary. It's more of a mystery. And you are basically determining the fate of these kids on this island, but the premise relies on the fact that you have a radio, and the radio can tune into frequencies that can detect anything from Morse code to the ghost channels to like weird radio broadcasts, all sorts of cool things.
But should I be putting a spoiler warning up for this, by the way?
Sure.
All right. Spoiler warning is now up.
So when you beat the game, you discover that this is one of those games where you can have multiple endings, but there's a deeper layer to the game where when you uncover all of the what the hell are those damn things? All of the Morse code, when you get all the Morse code, right? All the Morse code leads you to a secret ARG. And it is so freaking awesome. I can't even begin to tell you. It's basically an ARG that is a real world, like, it's going to lead you to, first, it leads you to a phone number. Oh my God. Great. That's fine. Hi, everybody. So no one can hear me right now, and I want you to know that all three of these gentlemen have the tiniest wieners.
I can fucking hear you, Jesse. Right here. Right. What the fuck?
None of us have played it yet. Come on.
You did such a good job of intriguing me with the premise. I thought I've got to play this now.
Anyway, so the
Keep it as
spoil the game.
All right, keep it as general as possible. Yeah.
So the ARG aspects of the game is that essentially you are going to this. It gives you Morse code.
He's keeping it general. He's keeping it vague.
Yeah. So the ARG, the Morse code, takes you to a phone number, Like all these things in the game, take you to a phone number. You call the phone number gives you another clue. That clue gives you another clue and just leads you down this path to the point where you end up on a Twitter account that is only giving out like tweets at 9 p.m. and 4 a.m. that have locations. So there's a huge Google Doc with all these people involved, and everyone is coming up with crazy theories about what this is, and they pinpointed it to somewhere in Washington State, like near Seattle, and no one knows what's going to be there. No one knows what's going to happen. I tweeted out, and the Twitter account was like, "In the next couple of days, something crazy is going to happen." I'm like, I don't know what any of that means. I'm in. I'm super in. Like, it's I can't spoil it. I will say, play the game, and when you play the game and beat it, you too will be like, I need to know what the answer is to this ARG. Like, it's so I'm in. It's got me. It hooked me. I'm in. It's such a the game's great. But the concept that they've created, when you beat the game, you're like, oh my god. So I'm 100% into this thing.
Okay.
Sold. I want to play it now, if not sooner.
Yeah. Yes. So, so play
it's only
it.
Like a 4-hour game.
Just don't listen to anything more that Jesse has to say on the subject.
Yeah, I can't. It's so hard to even talk about. Like, it's so good. Oh my god. Yeah, there's people have teamed up all over the world to solve this thing. And I can't wait. I can't wait to find out what the answer is.
It's interesting because there are occasionally games every now and again that create this weird zeitgeist, usually around the fact that they're deliberately obfuscating facts or whatever. I'm going to turn the spoiler warning off now.
Like Peter Molyneux's fucking shitty cube game.
Oh, that was the worst example of that. Like, that it's a really bad example because that was all artificially created mystery of, and it ended up being a box of bullshit, which is not what anyone really wanted. There are games that have done it well. Like one of them is Fez, for instance. When Fez first came out, there was a bunch of weird shit in the game that people didn't understand. And they were trying to work together to figure out these aspects of the world. And more stuff was being figured out. And I think he kind of patched the game to add more stuff in to create this weird mythos around it. And that drove this amazing amount of discussion about the game online. And that made the game a very interesting zeitgeist at the time, where everybody was, even if they weren't playing the game, they were like, what's going on? What is this? This is unusual. I want to know what's happening here. And every now and again, a game like that will come along and do it. And Oxenfree is one of them, which is awesome. Can you think of any other examples of games that have had that ARG, kind of alternate reality game element to it that...
I can't think of any games. Secret World did. I know Secret World had
a
lot of that.
Yes, it did. That was the best aspect of Secret World, incidentally. That was unfortunate that game... I mean, it's still going, actually. It's not dead. It's just that game didn't do as well as people hoped.
There was an old disc-based game that was in the early days of the internet that was sort of ARG-based. I cannot remember the name of it. It's like a murder mystery thing.
I do know what you're talking about. Oh, my God. Yes, I don't know what that's called, though.
I've got a box behind me, I think.
Let's have
a
look. Go find it.
I absolutely remember that because I remember every one of my friends. This was like mid-90s. Every one of my friends was into this. We totally didn't get it because it was way over our heads. But at the time, we were just like, oh, can you imagine? Like, that's so cool. And this, oh, yeah, no. I don't know too many video games that had ARG. But I know Lost every season in between seasons. They had an ARG, which I was... Since I loved Lost, I was in that every time they had something new.
Lost needed it too, because that's the kind of thing that drove its popularity between seasons, because people got desperate to watch the next one and they really got into the whole mythos of Lost. And then, of course, at the end, it's like, that was it? Really?
Yeah. The ARG actually, at the end, helped make the anger people had more intense, because they hyped up all this mythos and gave you nothing.
Nothing.
I think the Dark Knight, all the Joker websites and all the Joker reveals were an ARG. That was really good.
Did anybody play the Nokia game back in the day?
No. What was that?
That's probably a European only thing, but it was something to do with, you know, Nokia phones back when they existed. And you sort of played it through SMSs and you had to wait for certain television adverts to come on.
Interesting.
UK only and that thing. And I remember I sort of went along with it, then forgot about it for a day, and you got this phone call from a creepy child saying, oh, you've been watching, can you help me? And I'd totally forgotten about the game, and it scared the fucking shit out of me. until it sort of, oh, right, that's what it is. What was it? Calls from ghosts again. that was a weird thing. And it all built up to playing a really crappy web game where you had to snowboard down a hill or something.
And oh my god, I remember that game.
I'm looking this up to see if there's anything.
Yeah. And you literally had one go, and you're like, well, how did the controls... Oh, I've lost. Thanks. Yeah. For 3 weeks, I've been watching your NAF adverts. And...
I can't find any footage of any of this stuff, unfortunately. I think it was a very long time ago, but...
Were you talking about the game Majestic?
That may have been it.
Yeah. Majestic, July 31st, 2001, was an ARG developed by Electronic Arts. Wow.
Okay.
Ooh. And it was retail copies of the game included a CD-ROM and a copy of Internet Explorer and AIM and bonus music tracks that were MP3s, all of which were used in the Majestic 12 Shadow Conspiracy Theory game that used phone, email, AOL, Instant Messenger, BlackBerry messages, fax, and visiting special websites to help solve and beat the game.
I found the trailer for it, guys. Oh. I'm playing it right now. It is super, super old.
Oh, no idea what year that would have been.
The Majestic one is familiar. Plays but... you.
Yeah. Oh my god, that's a fax machine. Okay. This footage is incredible. This footage is the most Law and Order thing I've ever seen. Law and Order crossed with a really bad X-Files ripoff by the looks of it.
That sounds about right.
Yeah, that does ring a bell.
There's also a game called Treasure Quest. That was, if you could work together and figure out the clues, you had a chance of winning a dead professor's $1 million estate, was the premise of that game.
Yeah, I mean, that's basically what Ready Player One was based on, wasn't it? And also, I don't think it was Adventure, but it was a really, really old school Atari 2600 game, I think, that had, if you found the secret, you could send in something and you could get a real prize. I think they actually gave away like a real golden sword and some other stuff like that.
There's an ARG in the game I played this week. It's like an indie game.
Really? What was that?
What was it?
It was just like a link to a web URL, but apparently there's a whole bunch of other indie games that also have links in their games, and you have to like play them all and then like figure out the ARG. But I just like found the first one, and everyone's like, yeah, it's part of an ARG. And I was like, all right, cool, and just kept playing.
Well, that kind of defeated the point of the ARG, didn't it? It's like, oh, right, okay. Sword Quest was the name of it, of the game that would actually give you that. There was a prize. I can't remember. It was actual real treasure, if I recall correctly.
That's saying there was a game called Sword Quest?
Sword Quest, yes.
Makes sense.
There were several parts of it, apparently. It was developed by Dan Hitchens and Todd Fry, came out in 1982. They released three versions of it, Earthworld, Fireworld, and Waterworld. Each of them had a contest, and you had to get clues. So in Earthworld, it was, you had to get to clues. They had 5,000 entries, eight people got it right. Stephen Bell, who was 20 and lived in Detroit at the time, apparently, took first place and won the Talisman of Penultimate Truth, which was 18-carat solid gold with 12 diamonds and the birthstones of the 12 zodiac signs, valued at $25,000. Wow. It also had a small white gold sword attached to it. The second one was Fireworld, where they gave the Chalice of Light, which was a gold, platinum, and diamond and jade chalice, again worth about $25,000. And the last one never came out, apparently. There was supposed to be a contest for Waterworld, which was to receive the Crown of Life, which was made of gold with diamonds in it. Apparently, the contest was cancelled at the last minute due to the video game crash of the 80s.
There's a lot of that stuff around in the 80s. There are several sort of Spectrum ones. Automata, the company, did Pymania, which was one of these ones where you're the first person to complete the game and send the secret message you get off to the people. You win a cash prize. They did it again with something called My Name is Uncle Groucho, You Win a Fat Cigar, which has got to be one of the longest, most pointless titles for a video game.
I mean, at least they're honest about it.
Yeah, and you won money. You didn't even win a fat cigar.
You could use the money to buy the fat cigar.
I know. It's just blatant false advertising. And there was something called Hair Razor that is immensely complicated, and I'm still looking into, where some people cheated and won a sort of semi-ARG puzzle book thing called Masquerade, where you could win like this golden hair literally a sort of golden statue.
Okay.
They won it by cheating because they were naughty, and then formed a company around it, and then sold video games. You had to buy two, Hairraiser Prelude and Hairraiser Finale, I think, and both of them were far more expensive than the other game at the time. They weren't even games. It was just like this total confusing puzzle that nobody to this day has any idea how to solve and may not actually be solvable just because they wanted to keep the hair. They still went bust. Thieving git.
Anyone that's read Ready Player One is recognizing exactly where these plot threads came from now, aren't they? Because that's definitely that was one of the inspirations of it. I know Sword Quest was too, Adventure, and a bunch of other games from the 80s. The whole idea of this big contest was what that book was based on. So that's
a
the
film
thing
coming soon, isn't
it? There is. I'm looking forward to it, and it's a great time, in fact, to tell you about our sponsor this week, audible.com/cynical, who, among other things, also have Ready Player One, as read by Will Wheaton, if you're into that sort of thing. I've read that book. I enjoyed that a great deal. And we have an offer for you. You can actually pick up a 30-day free trial of Audible right here at audible.com/cynical. And we're going to show you a few of the books that we like on Audible.
Do it, yo.
This is my list.
Favorite book.
I'll show you your favorite book, Dodger, is this one right here. Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone is your favorite book.
Oh, Jesus Christ. I mean, yeah, it's my favorite. I love it.
That great endorsement. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. That's Dodger's favorite book, by the way. Apparently Strippin.
Hey, that's me.
Doesn't know. You're not Dodger. This, however,
she actually picked that as her favorite book.
She did. We were asked to send in screenshots of our favorite audiobook, and she picked that one.
All right, we're having words.
Dodger is a literal child. That is clear. However, we have
her
someone
child
that
who thinks all British people know magic is also the thing, which is. She was really fucking disappointed when she, you know,
when she learned that all British people didn't know magic.
By the way, I don't know magic.
Oh, okay. I was going to say we have a more mature list here from Jesse, but that's not at all true because they're all Star Wars books.
Yes, yep. when you host a Star Wars podcast that talks about the books, this is the single best thing you can own is Audible and get all those books. I still have to read Tarkin, but
read.
They're great. Star Wars books are legit like radio plays. Sound effects, the music, all of it's in there. It's great. It's great. You should definitely, if you want to know what's going on and you can't wait for December, jump in on that, yo.
Wait, so when you told me to read Aftermath, I can actually just Audible Aftermath.
I told you to get the Audible version because the book version is written in present tense.
Actually, you told me to watch your podcast on it.
No. That's true. I'm not going to not shill to you.
Sellout boys.
Yeah, yeah. But if you don't want to listen to guys sit around and talk about the new discoveries we made, by the way, did you know this is a true thing that we
learned? Oh, God.
The music in Star Wars that Max Rebo plays is called Jizz.
Okay. Wow. That's an interesting
fact. That's not a joke. It's a true thing because apparently before that became a derogatory term, they thought, we'll call it jazz, but we'll just change the letter.
To jizz.
To jizz.
Perfect.
Totally true. Totally true. I don't think it's Max Rebo. I think it's the guys in the cantina in episode 4. Whatever the case may be.
What if jizz came about because the music was so good and people just started jacking it?
I like to think it's Star Wars.
And they were
Wars
like, what are you doing? And yeah. When they get caught, I'm like jacking it with the music on. And he was like, I'm jizzing. I'm jizzing right now.
Well, any chance we had of renewing this sponsorship is now right out the window, but hey, never mind. Yes, go and listen to these books, definitely, on audible.com/cynical, because we're never getting this again.
You are literally, I'm just going to say this, you're literally a dummy if you have a car and you aren't just driving around listening to books in your car.
Yeah, it's the best time to do it.
It's such a good time to do it. And more importantly, you can get through, especially if you live in a crowded-ass city, or if you take the subway or a bus, turn off the tunes, get a book. There's thousands of books there, millions of books.
There's actually 180,000 books available on Audible, all read by professionals.
12 million books are on there.
Yep. No, there aren't. That's false advertising, no.
All of them are not just Star Wars or Harry Potter. There's actually, like, even the classics are on there. So
there are at least three books on there that are not Star Wars or Harry Potter, that I can confirm.
Yes, it's true. If someone says to you, have you ever read Jane Eyre? First off, say no, because that's an awful book. But then say, I'll give it a shot and go listen to it on Audible. Because, any Jane Eyre books, throw it in a lake. Just get rid of it. Listen to it on Audible. It'll go by much faster. Books that celebrities write, right? Like all of their the comedy books and stuff are literally read by those comedians on Audible. It's legit. You're a dummy if you don't get it. And that's all I have to say to you. It's been, I subscribe to like the one free book a month thing. I'm doing it. I got two.
Yeah.
So Disney bought the rights to Jizz.
Great. That's wonderful information. I'll show you my list of books, I guess. There we go. Just a quick gander at that. There's some of them. I haven't listened to all of them yet. Of this, I would absolutely recommend Good Omens by Neil Gaiman and the late, great Terry Pratchett, which is absolutely phenomenal if you haven't read that or listened to that. And what I will say is that pretty much all of the Discworld books that are available on Audible are fantastic. They're all very well narrated by a old British man, which is exactly what you want to hear. If you have no idea how to start with Discworld, I would recommend Mort. That's usually the best way for most people to get into the series. You don't have to read them in order. In fact, it's recommended that you don't. But Mort is a really good stepping point. You don't have to know much about the universe to understand that. Other ones on here that I'm currently listening to are Futuristic Violence and Fancy Suits by David Wong. It is very fun. It is about a woman in the future who learns that she's come into an inheritance from her estranged father. She doesn't exactly know what it is, but for some reason there are people in fancy suits trying to kill her, so she is trying her best not to get shot in the future, which is awesome. And I like that a lot. There's plenty of good stuff. I'm also trying to listen to Off to Be the Wizard, actually, by Scott Meyer. You can see right there, who is... it's a book about a man who gets to be part of a video game, and apparently it's not as cool as he thinks. He's trapped in a video game world.
We're giving recommendations? Hold on.
You've just given the recommendations. I told you to recommend Star Wars.
Okay,
one more. You get one more.
On Audible, go get Lords of the Sith. It's imagine a book where Darth Vader is basically the Terminator, and it is hilarious. That dude, he murders everyone. He flies, he launches himself from a TIE fighter into a ship mid-space and kills everyone on board. He is the Terminator. It is the greatest book you will ever listen to. Ever, because all it is sound effects. It's like as he's choking people,
as he's killing people. If you want to hear 3 hours of people getting force choked to death, apparently Lords of the Sith is the way to go.
It is legit.
I would suggest one.
Okay,
The Poet's Corner. It's poetry for the whole family, voiced by Morgan Freeman and Helen Mirren.
Oh no!
Oh, I bet that's so good.
I bet that is absolutely dreadful. Oh, dear God. Yeah, you can pick up a free trial over at audible.com/cynical. That is audible.com/cynical. 30-day free trial, and then after that, you basically buy a membership, and you can get any book you want, and you get a credit, or two, or three, or four every month.
The monthly sub? It's not that much.
Depends which sub you get. Some of them are more than others. You can basically get whatever sub you want, or you can buy a la carte, and it's awesome. I listen to this quite a bit. And you can also listen to them on any device. So I listen on my phone, I listen on my iPad, and also on my PC. That's the PC menu. You can deliver it to any device or just download the file, or you can just play it over their web player. Audible.com/cynical. There's our shilling done. Cool. Excellent. We're going to be back after the break.
Jump on that bandwagon. Get it, guys.
Go do it. We're going to be back after the break with more video game discussion.
And of course, see what I played, man.
Yeah, I haven't asked you anything. We've got an hour more of that to go, man. Got to save the best till last. You can tell me more about your Pokken tournament nonsense.
You really played to his vanity.
Clutched that out.
Yeah.
Clutched that out, boy.
Played to his vanity. Real nice there.
Yeah, you hit me in the heartstrings.
Thanks to the Audible sponsor. We will not be running any ads today. We'll be right back. Enjoy the music. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Co-Optional Podcast. The second hour or so of the show. We have more talking to do.
Jesse, I found that game.
In Memoriam.
Interesting. Yeah. If I remember, I got it years and years after it was sort of first came out. Tried to play it and half the websites were offline.
Hmm. That sucks. What does the back of the box say? Give us the spiel.
He kills according to a specific ritual and is inspired by a distant past. To defeat him, you have two assets, your intuition and the internet. an investigation game on the edge of reality. Play against a serial killer. Investigate all over Europe from Paris to Istanbul. Attempt to solve the Phoenix's dark games and riddles. Yeah. Use the internet as an investigation tool. Communicate with characters via email and analyze video excerpts, photos, and soundtracks. Hmm. An internet connection is required to play in memoriam in order to access websites to research clues and receive and send email. A low bandwidth is sufficient.
A low bandwidth, so probably 33.6K modem back then, most likely.
Yeah, it literally says internet connection needed, 56.6K modem.
Yeah.
You do need a 16-bit Sound Blaster compatible sound card, though.
Oh, shit. My blood is not that rich, I'm afraid.
333 megahertz processor and 64 megabytes of RAM. Who could afford that?
Not many, I imagine.
Unbelievable, Jeff.
Jeff?
That's a football expression. Don't worry, TV.
Oh, I have no idea what you're talking about.
Don't worry.
What's this unbelievable Jeff
Unbelievable
nonsense?
Jeff? Well, yeah, what does it mean?
Unbelievable Jeff. He's a really crap superhero. Lies all the time.
Is that his special power, or is it just a side effect of it?
Yes. Yeah, it's like, was it Cassandra who was had the power of future prophecy, but was cursed that nobody would believe her.
No one actually believed her. That's a pretty classic thing, isn't it? The whole idea of, I know the future. It's like, we don't believe you. Shit.
There's a football commentator called Jeff Stelling, and there was another guy that commentates matches with him, and he would always say, unbelievable Jeff, when something unbelievable happened. And so it coined the phrase, unbelievable Jeff, when something is unbelievable.
Makes sense. End.
What sort of unbelievable stuff happens during a football match?
I mean, we can only imagine.
I'd like to point out that
I can't imagine much going on in a football match. You've got to be honest about that one.
Yeah, not as unbelievable.
No. There's a ball. It's being kicked. This is incredible.
The ball has turned into a goblin.
Now that is unbelievable. Mm. Oh, hello. We have other boxes.
Hello. Planescape Torment.
These are the only games I have at my house.
They're the only games you need at your house.
They're good ones. They're good ones.
This is all I got.
Homeworld was a good one.
It was, although you can now pick up the remastered version, which is pretty damn good, although they did change some of the mechanics around. You're now completely silent. Oh, no, you're eating. Okay, you're not silent at all. You're just being lazy. All right, good.
It's carrots.
So?
I didn't want to crunch the carrot in your ear. I'm sorry.
How does that excuse it? You picked the crunchiest food possible and decided to eat it now.
Because I wanted it.
Yeah, you need like soft oatmeal cookies like me.
Oh my god.
I have some Jaffa cakes.
Son of a bitch.
I mean.
Oh.
Yes.
All I've got are these weird Chinese marshmallows.
Don't eat them. They're 100 years old.
No, they're in dates. They've got fruit jelly filling. Unfortunately, I don't know what fruit it is, but it tastes bloody awful. It's some devious fruit I'm not aware of. It's kind of like strawberry or raspberry. Yeah, it's just kind of. Maybe a bit orangey. Aftertaste of sort of almonds. Could be poison, cyanide. That taste of almonds, doesn't it?
That's true. I mean, as opposed to very orangey, such as these McVitie's digestives with orange.
Oh, I did not know they existed.
They do, and they're good. I wonder if they make a hobnob variant of this. That might be the best thing ever made by mankind, if that were true.
Mm. A chocolate hobnob with orange?
Yeah, man. That's got to exist, right? I'm going to Google it. I bet it does. I'm going to order some. I'm going to order a box of them. 10 boxes of them. Hobnob orange.
Gotta get them hobnobs, yo.
Milk, chocolate, and orange hobnob on a nice cup of tea and a sitdown.com, which is, it's their biscuit of the week for 2006.
Oh my god, that's what I'm on. But it was in 2006. They might not exist anymore.
These might not exist anymore. Shit.
Cup of tea and a sit down. I haven't heard of that for years.
Nice cup of tea and a sitdown.com.
Oh god. Yeah. Please tell me I can buy these. There's got to be Hobnobs Biscuits. All right, I'm going to their website. Do they still make them? They make chocolate chip, which is okay. Not brilliant. Vanilla cream, no. Wet. They don't bloody make them, do they?
All right, they've got milk chocolate chip, dark chocolate, vanilla cream, chocolate cream.
It's not good enough.
Blackjack and slices. They don't have it.
Slices? Yeah, they have slices. They're kind of like,
They're like cake slices. Cake slices. Like Hobnob cake slices.
Oh, I saw.
I mean, they'll be all right.
Like a weird, vague name.
No, they're like Mr. Kipling style.
Slices. They'll be all right, but honestly, where's the orange one? I mean, really, what's going on with that? It's just, I'm just not impressed. McVitie's used to be better than this.
Although, Hobnob's chocolate creams could be pretty good.
Oh, yeah. They're all right. I mean, the chocolate chip one's good. The original knobbly one is good. I like Hobnobs. I like all Hobnobs.
That is disappointing.
But the lack of chocolate and orange Hobnob is really disappointing. Not happy with that. Not one little bit.
Could you make your own?
Yeah. In theory, I could. I'd have to... So I get regular Hobnobs and then make a chocolate orange sauce and then dip them in it and then let them dry in the freezer, right?
Maybe peel bits off Jaffa cakes.
Doable. You know, demolishing a Jaffa cake is not difficult. You know, it's a relatively simple process. You break it the side and then the top starts to peel off there, and then you can peel the chocolate away and you can get
You've done this before. So you can get the
smashing orangey bit right out of the middle, like that. See?
New YouTube series, Totalbiscuit totally makes biscuits.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. 5% of the rad revenue.
Oh, please. That would actually... I'd watch that.
And you can have this...
I would watch that.
Him making
biscuits.
Uh-huh.
I can do it.
Biscuit making biscuits. That's it. There it is.
I don't know. Smash an orange bit out of the middle. I put these in a blender yesterday. And I had a milkshake with them, and it was pretty great.
What is going on in your life? That is amazing. You literally are just like, I have no time to eat all of them one by one.
Back in a net. I need, they're time consuming. I can have them in liquid form. I can have them IV, dripped. Like, I don't have to do a thing. It's just, I'm in a weird stage in my life.
I'm blending this whole pack of biscuits.
I'm in a weird place in my life where kale is in everything, and I'm learning how to make Thai food. It's just a bit strange.
Do you, after you make, like, the milkshakes and stuff, do you put them in, like, one of those hats that has straws to your mouth? Just so you can keep playing games?
You
so
have found me out.
Gravity just feeds it down into your mouth.
Just like, and because it's a milkshake, it's quite thick, so it's just slowly trickles in.
Yeah.
No time for that, just... injected directly into the stomach.
Yeah. I mean, half of that went in it yesterday, and it was like, there you go. Malteser teasers. Excellent. Bit of Noosa coconut right here. Best yogurt in the world, that.
Oh, my God.
Oh, it's good. It's it claims to be Australian yogurt, but it's made in Colorado, because of course it is. So there's that.
Australia's the... Colorado's the Australia of America, essentially.
Yeah.
Really?
I imagine so. There is basically half a coconut in that yogurt, and it's wonderful. It's just a nice big chunk of coconut. Love it.
TV, I thought you were in a kitchen, and then I realized you're in an armory.
Yes. My newest addition right here to the collection is the...
Oh my God.
This is the Tokyo Marui AA-12 automatic shotgun. This is, needless to say, not a real gun. I collect airsoft. I don't collect real guns. But the missus decided to get me a gift, which was very kind of her. This is maybe the most expensive gun I own now, because this is the world's first automatic electric three-shot shotgun. So it fires 3 BBs at a time at about 1,200 rounds a minute, and it's fully electrically powered, which is lovely, frankly.
It's just a fraction away from being a real gun.
Yeah, I mean, it's close to hurting someone.
You could still kill a man.
Yeah. I mean, it's nice. I mean, look at that full polymer construction. It's fucking lovely. It came in a lovely box. It's unbelievably well designed. I'm going to look forward to this. I'm going to load this, and then I'm going to go shoot in the garden as I do. It's going to be great.
With a milkshake hat.
With a milkshake hat and my kale smoothie. It's
America.
America. It's... I mean, to be fair, you can also get these in England, because airsoft is legal in England, as it bloody well should be. Incidentally, the magazine for this is amazing. It's got a fucking sledgehammer written on the side of it. It's got a groove, so it slides in the way it's supposed to. Like, just smooth. Yeah, racking it. There we go. So, that is the Tokyo Marui AA-12, and I'm looking forward to fucking with it. And now I'm going to fix my microphone here. There we go.
I thought he was going to say, like, fucking someone up.
I'm looking forward to fucking it. Like, quite literally, I, you know... It's
I'm looking forward to fucking destroying
times,
my neighbor.
Come to desperate measures.
Just yeah. a prank, bro.
Indeed. Yep. AA-12. There's quite a few games that the AA-12 has been in, actually. It's a very fun gun. Games? Mr. Xbox Ahoy could probably tell you. He has a great series on games that are in video, well, guns that are in video games. And he's mentioned quite a few interesting ones. Yeah, a giant bomb actually has a list of games with the AA-12 automatic shotgun in it. There's quite a few that include Infestation, Survivor Stories. Well, I mean...
Your gun just lost value.
Yeah. I think I'm going to have to return this now. Spec Ops: The Lion had it. Modern Warfare 3 has it. Killing Floor has the AA-12, which is the most British fucking game. There is nothing more British than Dosh, grab it while you can, lads, which is Killing Floor in a nutshell. Nation Red, The Club, Dead Frontier. There's been quite a few games with AA-12. It's a fun gun. I think it was in Max Payne as well, actually, if I recall correctly.
Oh God, the first one? No,
I don't know if it was the first one. Let's see, AA-12 Max Payne, and AA-12. I think it was in Max Payne 3, by the looks of it. Possibly.
I never played the third.
Oh, I actually know it wasn't the AA-12. It was the Pancor Jackhammer, which is not a real gun. So the Pancor Jackhammer, little story about this gun, has been in a lot of video games. It's a very distinctive looking automatic shotgun. It looks really futuristic. It's kind of crazy. And as a result, a lot of video games picked it up. The thing is, this gun was never actually put into production. This is the only prototype that exists that I've put up on the screen right now. It was designed, I think, by a guy who was a Korean War veteran who used to be a shotgunner. And he decided, you know what, shotguns are terrible, I'm going to make a better one. And he designed it, he never was never able to sell it, so there's only one remaining. But it's been in a bunch of video games, despite the fact that that gun has never existed. And it's called the Jackhammer in most video games. I'm going to see if there's a list. There's going to be a list of games that have the Jackhammer in it.
It sounds familiar.
Yeah, you're probably quite familiar with it. It was in Max Payne. It was in Fallout 2. It was in the original Far Cry. It was in the original Battlefield 2. Rainbow Six 3. Some of All Fears. Fallout Tactics. Project IGI. Delta Force Land Warrior. 762 High Caliber. Warface Ghost Recon Phantoms. Counter-Strike Online. The Darkness had it. Battlefield
Adrian
3 had
Brody
it.
Adrian Brody used it in Predators.
Did he?
Apparently, that's what the internet tells me. That's the first time it was in a movie.
Yeah, it has been in quite a few movies because people really like the look of it because it looks very futuristic. But in reality, this gun was never mass-produced, and there is only one left in the world that is, I believe, functional. Kind of sad story, really. The guy raised a ton of money. It was obviously a very good gun, and then nobody bought it. So there you go.
Politics.
There's a lot of that. There's a lot of politics involved in it. You know,
don't worry, man. Trump will bring it back.
He bloody well better not.
Gotta shoot something.
Hugely impractical. Like, do we actually need a shotgun that's that ridiculous? Probably not. But yeah, go ask Trump about the Pancor Jackhammer and whether or not he will make America great again with it. If so, please don't vote for him. All right, that's the political stuff out of the way. Let's get back to video games. So, after the gun nerding out, what else have we been playing? Who's going to throw a hat in the ring? I got a few, but...
I played a really good game.
What's that?
This week. It was called Moonhunters.
Oh, yes, I recall
you... Square Enix game? The one that Square was trying to, like... It was part of their like, Kickstarter program they have?
I don't know. All I know is developed by a friend of Steven, who does the roleplay stuff with us.
Yeah, Steven Lumpkin, yes.
Yeah. So get indie developed game, but like basically it's four player multiplayer. It's a very short, sporadic role play game, but with like hundreds of different branches. And basically, you start off on the continent with randomly generated locations, and depending on who you meet and who you speak to and what you do, the ending is adjusted to compensate. And you unlock things each playthrough, and then you play again with a different character, and you unlock more stuff. And it was really, really fun and cool.
Is it out, or did you get a...
Yeah, it's out.
I think it's out. It's coming out. I think it just came out on GOG yesterday. Cool. But it's already on Steam.
Yeah, this was part of Square Enix's collective initiative that they're doing, where they like pick out a few games that they think are really, really good, and they promote the hell out of them. Mm. This was one of those. So
yeah, it was great. I loved it. It was really good, and it also has online multiplayer too, so you can play with friends.
Interesting. I'm gonna look that up.
What's the name of it again? Sorry,
Moonhunters.
You sods are gonna cost me a fortune.
This tends to happen every now and again, especially if we had a good week. We're not done yet either. We've got plenty more. I heard some people were criticizing the actual combat gameplay of Moonhunters. Like that wasn't that good. What do you reckon to that? As someone that plays quite a lot of ARPGs.
I mean, the combat really isn't a big element of the game. It's like there's like boss encounters, and the boss encounters are totally fine. The combat isn't the standout aspect of the game. The standout aspect is like the exploration and just trying to get the different endings and stuff. But I didn't have any issues with the combat whatsoever. And I played every class. Some of them are harder than others, obviously, but there's like little merchants throughout the game, and you can save up points during that playthrough, and then you can like buy upgrades for your combat and stuff. I don't know, like, me and Dodger streamed it for like 7 hours, and wow. No one complained about the combat.
Yeah, there was a few people that for some reason, definitely on Steam, were saying that the game's combat was lacking and that they didn't like it as a result. I think maybe they went into it expecting Diablo and didn't get it.
Yeah, or expecting like Divinity Original Sin or something. It's not that kind of game.
I like the aesthetic of it. I'm not 100% keen on the character art, but I like the actual game itself. It looks pencil by the looks of it, very pencil style. A little bit of an Asian influence to it, I think. You know, a little bit of Japanese, maybe a little bit of oil painting in there. But it is a co-op game. I did like the idea that apparently what you do affects the outcome. I love games like that. I'm big into them.
The game, you'll be given like options, choices and stuff, and depending on what you do, you get like attributes. You might get like, you might save a snake even though it's venomous, and then you get like the brave attribute, and that will let you approach a lion. But if you don't have the brave attribute, you can't approach the lion. So like getting different characteristics opens up different branches for the game, and then like adjusts the end game to compensate.
That is very Divinity though, where it's the idea of like, I unlocked the ability to talk to a dog so that can change my questing kind of.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, but literally I think like it takes you maybe 20 minutes to beat the game.
What?
It's like very, very short. Basically what happens is that the game takes place in a 3-day window, and so you can visit 4 places in that playthrough, but then the next time you play through the game again and you visit like 4 different places to try and see how you can get a better ending. And so, like, you end up playing through the game. I think we played through 12 times with different characters, because you unlock, like, they have, like, a star system, and you unlock different stuff in the star system, and you keep going. It's pretty cool.
You know, I like this idea, because some people really hate that the game is short like that. But to me, that's an advantage.
Wears it well.
If it's got replayability, and if the whole point is that every time you do it, you get different story outcomes, that is what I want. That to me is great. I would rather play a bunch of rounds of that.
Instead of a 200-hour Divinity game, you have a 20-minute game that you can like play in small chunks and have different outcomes and play different characters. It's really cool.
I think there's huge value in that. And I don't think that... And the weird thing is that there's actually quite a few games that already do it, but don't really do it in the same way. Basically, Moonhunters is aping things like Binding of Isaac, that have, they're based around short runs. Nobody ever claimed Binding of Isaac was not good value because of that. The whole point is that you keep playing it multiple times and different things happen every time.
Yeah, it's exactly like that. Like, you go to a place and the enemies are randomly generated, and there might be a merchant, there might be a boss that appears and you have to fight the boss. It's just like, it's completely like RNG.
I want to play that now. I want to play a lot of that, actually. That's on the list of, I'm going to play a bunch of sessions of this. God damn it. I'm going to have no time left.
I just bought it. This looks so cool.
It is co-op, but it's 1 to 4 players, so we can maybe run through it. And Stuart can probably back me up on this one. A lot of us grew up on the back of Choose Your Own Adventure and fighting fantasy books.
Oh, yes.
Indeed.
Mm-hmm. We certainly did. I have an almost complete selection of Final Fantasy books, fighting fantasy books.
Easy mistake to make. I keep saying that.
At the office, I have volumes 1 through 33 of Choose Your Own Adventure. I've been meaning to do a series where I just read one and then have people animate it. That's like my dream but I don't know the legal ramifications of that, so I haven't done it yet. I haven't really done it yet, but I've always wanted to do that.
A long time ago.
I had the mountain survival one. I got froze to death every bloody attempt.
I think I had that one too, yeah. It's like, Choose Your Own Adventure, I think, was bigger in the United States, whereas Fighting Fantasy, I think, took off a lot. It's not that you couldn't get them in the UK, you could, but I remember Starship Traveler, which I think is Volume 5 of Fighting Fantasy, which was unbelievably unfair. In fact, most of them were really unfair. That was kind of the point. But the difference between those games and Choose Your Own Adventure is they had a combat system that involved dice.
Huh.
It was like a single-player RPG. Not very good one, but a single-player RPG nonetheless.
There's internal dice rolls in this one, too. Like, you can try to do something, and you can fail it and succeed it.
Yeah. The cool thing about those books, or indeed the worst thing about those books, is that failing a dice roll could literally just kill you and end the story immediately.
Yeah.
Or just sometimes like they felt like it.
Just on the page, it just says you are dead.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. There are two doors ahead. They're both the same. Do you want to go left or right? Left, you are dead.
Dead, yeah.
Thanks.
The later ones tended to realize that they were being horribly unfair and started to write into the dialogue clues that would reveal to you that you were going the wrong way or that you made the wrong call. But especially the early ones, it was possible to get on a path where you could not win and get there on that path very early on to the point where you couldn't do a damn thing. So you could do a choice early that fucked you for the entire game, and you wouldn't know until you'd read 20 more pages of it, at which point it killed you. That's not ideal.
That even gets around the classic keep your thumb in the page when you go in case there's an instant death.
They knew that was going to happen, which is why they did that. It's so that you didn't, because the whole choose the wrong door thing, you could scum very easily. You stick your thumb in, it's like, oh, I failed, I'm going to turn back and keep going, which is your own call, you can do that. But
there's actually a really great, in one of the Choose Your Own Adventures, I don't remember if it's the ninja one, there's one of them, it might be the time travel one, whatever the case may be, you literally in like the first maybe six or seven choices have the option to just not do it. Just be like, you know, this doesn't sound cool. You flip the page, it's like, you go home and go to sleep for the night and wake up the next day and go back to school. Like, that's it. This is crazy.
It's a Far Cry 4 ending. Yeah.
Yeah.
Or a Shadow Complex ending. That kind of thing. It's like, you know what? This is not worth the hassle.
No.
No.
I'm not going to do that. I'm going home. This is crazy.
Awful idea. Just terrible. The weird thing is that these game books have had something of a revival now, thanks to iOS. You can get not only quite a few of the Fighting Fantasy books, but you can get a full, this is probably the best series that exists, Sorcery, which was Steve Jackson. Yeah. So it was Fighting Fantasy, but it was a bit more advanced. And it's by the Inkle guys, the guys that made 80 Days, which was an excellent game. You can play Sorcery 1 through 3 on iOS and Steam, and they are probably the pinnacle of what most of those games could do. They had advanced systems. They had some really interesting ideas about their spell system because it used a series of code words and you'd learn the spells. And if you didn't know the spell, you wouldn't know which page to turn because it instead of using just page numbers, it used code words, which was really cool. There's also a Judge Dredd one, which is really good on iOS. And there's a Warhammer 40,000 one, which is unbelievably unfair. Oh, it was that I've died. I tried to beat it on a plane. And I couldn't. I just couldn't do it. I died so many fucking times. It's like, you stuck around a little bit too long. You were eaten by Tyranids. Enjoy this. This happens to you constantly. It's brutal. Absolutely brutal. But that was the attraction of those games. Like, because they were really hard. And when you eventually beat them, it was really satisfying. Not to mention it was about trying to get kids to actually read books. So if you put a game element in them, a lot of us were like, oh, books are awesome. What? Mm-hmm.
Oh. Going back to games which are incredibly short, but you go over them again and again, there's an old interactive fiction game called Isle, which has literally, you know, interactive history, you know, examine, potato, drop,
text-based adventure, sort of basically.
Exactly, text adventures, we used to call them. And you only have one turn, and then the game restarts. And you're just in a supermarket aisle, and you can slowly sort of piece together this story of what's happened to the character in it. It's quite interesting. God knows how you'd play it these days through some sort of interpreter, but
I
it must
I believe
be at least 15 years old, probably older. wasn't like a commercial release or anything.
Yeah, I believe because they used to be called interactive fiction. Now, of course, that term is kind of being hijacked by people who are making walking simulators, essentially, and saying, we're interactive fiction. It's like, no, you're not. Interactive fiction was a text adventures. That was the name of the genre for the longest time.
It was fiction that was interactive.
Yeah.
There's the clue, guys. You weren't walking along and going, can I have a bit of story now? Please.
Okay. I mean, I'll look at the flowers. I can't interact with them in any way, but I'll look at them, right? Can I have a pretentious man ramble for a while? No, I've got to get 20 feet further. All right. Okay, yes.
I want to be the pretentious voiceover in one of those games.
You'd be ideal for it. I don't know why you haven't been picked up yet.
You are horribly pretentious. I don't know why I was.
I know. Absolutely. I mean, I could do it off the top of my head. Edna was depressed. There were no more flowers in the garden that she could relate to. And yet, by taking a few more steps forward, perhaps the future would hold what her past had sadly withheld from her. There we are. Write a game around that.
Perfect.
It could be like 8-bit graphics except in 3D.
10 out of 10. Polygon.
Yep. Done.
Instantly.
Call me video game man.
I believe you mean woman. This is current year, after all. 2016.
Video game person.
Person,
duck. I want this game written by a duck.
A duck. There's nothing more progressive than a duck.
A gender-neutral duck.
Gender-neutral duck.
Yes.
Who had some very good hits in the 70s. It was a prog rock band, I believe.
His hair. His feathers sort of whopped in front.
Just over one eye.
Mm-hmm. Over one eye.
Hey, wait, like this.
They're still touring. It's unbelievable. They're so old now, but still going at it.
Sam, you are the gender-neutral progressive rock duck of this podcast. One little swoop, and there you go. Yep.
The chat is now full of ducks. Oh, God.
Whack.
Yes, so you can't have interactive fiction. You can't have roguelike either. They both have specific definitions. Quit fucking with them. If you want to call it something, think of something else. I like virtual installation. I think is good. Because it's basically an art exhibit. You walk through it, you experience it. You wanted your games to be art? Then call them art. Stop calling them games.
Speaking of being overwhelmed by a lot of things, I'm looking at chat and it's just all geese right now.
It's all geese and ducks. Yeah, it's nothing but.
You mentioned roguelite or roguelike, whatever the case may be.
Yes.
There have been an overwhelming tidal wave of those games over the last 2 years.
Yeah.
I'm just like, where was it decided that this was the game people wanted? Like, this is the style of game people wanted. Is it because of things like
Isaac's fault.
Finding of Isaac? Yeah, is it because of that? Or
yeah, that's exactly
just
why.
Came out of nowhere.
Yeah, so the revival of the genre, which really is not a revival of the genre per se, because it's not a roguelike. Because roguelike, it has a specific definition, and these games don't really fulfill them. They are roguelike-likes, or roguelites. You know, I like roguelite. I think that's a nice term. Mm-hmm. Those games go back to the early 80s, possibly even late 70s, with games like Hack, NetHack specifically, with games like Rogue, which is why it's called roguelike, and then games like Angband and Umoria. And those were games where you played a dude, or a woman, whatever, or a goblin, you know, goblin dude, goblin woman, whichever you liked. You had lots of different choices. You were actually represented by a text symbol. Usually you were at, as in, you know, at gmail.com. You were a walking at. Everything else was a letter. So you went and fight lowercase t's and uppercase w's. Very dangerous, uppercase w's. And they usually represented different monsters. And the game only moved when you did. So it was pseudo turn-based. You could actually play the turns through real fast. As soon as you pressed left to move, that's a turn. You press to attack, that's a turn. So you can take turns real quick, or you can take them really, really slow.
So is SUPERHOT a roguelike?
I'm going to go with probably not.
That's because it isn't.
Yes.
You don't say.
I'm going to assume probably not, although it could have been, interestingly. But that's not the only thing that they featured. That was the way you could identify that particular genre, but they had a bunch of other things. They usually featured permadeath. They usually featured an overworld, which was a town hub with a randomly generated dungeon. So in the town hub, you could buy shit, and then you went down into the dungeon, and it was randomly generated, and you encountered stuff. Umoria and Angband were all based on Lord of the Rings. So you could get in there, and I believe it was possible, based on kind of weird randomness, that you walked in there and immediately Sauron showed up and you died. It was a little brutal. Most of the time it was you are fighting a bag of worms or a dog. But sometimes one of the randoms would show up. It's like, this is Grimoire Wormtongue. He is level 99 and casts 5,000 spells and you die immediately.
Locked in an intense battle with a bag of worms.
With a bag of worms. There was,
I'm losing, they've got me.
There's a
how fucking bad adventurer do you have to be? I don't get it about games nowadays where they're like, kill rats, kill, you know, puppies to level up, kill the flowers.
It's been a thing for a while, hasn't it?
Kill the pigs.
So the name of the monster specifically.
These things even fight back. Why is this even a thing?
You have to learn to kill.
You need to start somewhere and learn to kill.
Fuck, then kill a man. Kill a man in his... Kill a man.
Grab this week on career advice.
Kill a man. Preferably two. So the name of the mob that we're talking about was the White Worm Mass. So it is literally a pile of tiny worms. The description of it.
White Worm Mass used to tour with Gender Neutral Duck.
I believe they did. They were in support. They did have some issues with their drummer. They had to swap them out later.
Death metal's finest.
Indeed. So the description, because every monster had a very detailed description, because you could look at them, and that was part of it, because obviously the game didn't have graphics, it was all about, you know, so they described the monsters to you. It is a large, slimy mass of worms. This natural creature is normally found at the depths of 50 feet, and moves extremely erratically and slowly. It's rarely detected by telepathy. It breeds explosively, it's hurt by bright light, but resists poison and rock removal. It cannot be frightened. It is fairly observant of intruders, which it may notice from 70 feet away. It can crawl on you to poison with damage of 1d2.
It can crawl
on you?
Sure,
that's not a description of me.
I mean, it's pretty close, come to think of it.
That's what you're known for. You're
1d2 damage. Yep.
1d2 Ashens, yeah.
There were actually a wide variety of worm masses of different types, and worm farming was a known grinding method to level up as a low-level character quickly. Because worms bred explosively, so if you didn't use AoE, they'd breed faster than you could kill them. So if you had the right armor, you could literally just kill them infinitely and level up off them. You'd also get drops and things like that.
If you had to recommend one modern roguelike... for somebody who hasn't played them before, which one would you recommend?
I would recommend Dungeons of Dreadmoor.
That's a great game.
It is. So Dungeons of Dreadmoor is, unlike things like Isaac, which are roguelike inspired, very much an actual roguelike, but it has actual graphics.
I'd also recommend Crypt of the Necrodancer with a dance pad.
Which is inspired by roguelikes, very much so. The interesting thing about Crypt of the Necrodancer is its movement system is very roguelike. Because it's move when you do. But if you want to play a very traditional one, Dungeons of Dreadmoor is $5 and is fucking hilarious. It's hard, yes, definitely, but it has all of the elements of a traditional roguelike, including monster zoos. There was a term known as monster zoo when the algorithm decided to spawn way too many monsters in one room, and it was called a zoo. And you would end up usually getting killed by them, but they could also drop really good loot because there was a lot of dudes. This game is like, oh yeah, monster zoos. We're going to put them in the game as an actual thing, and we're going to call them that. So Dungeons of Dreadmoor is a definite one. Other ones, Ancient Domains of Masochism. Adon. Yeah.
Sounds like the worst nightclub ever.
It is a really bad one, honestly. The cover charge is awful. But you can pick up this game for $15, and that used to be a text-based roguelike, and then they gave it graphics. So you can actually play it in the original mode, which is the dots and the slashes and the ats and everything. But roguelikes are really cool. It's an interesting genre. But as you said, they've now become the en vogue genre, I suppose. Because of things like Binding of Isaac. Dreadmoor did come out before that, I believe, but I don't think it inspired a generation of actual roguelikes. But we had things like Isaac, and then games that had roguelike elements, Spelunky, Cave Story, things like that, have a little bit of roguelike in them, a little bit of spice. And then you've got like Darkest Dungeon, Risk of Rain, that all have elements of roguelike in them, but they're not actual roguelikes.
Right.
So
if I had to recommend, I would go for Sword of the Stars, The Pit.
I love that. That is an actual roguelike as well, and it's one of the few sci-fi roguelikes. Yep. It's difficult, but you know what I love about that game? The art style. It reminds me of old DOS games. It reminds me of like the original XCOM and things like that. It's awesome, and it's a space one. You know, a lot of the roguelikes are not sci-fi. They're fantasy. So it's one of the rare ones that is not that. And it
what
also
was the ocean game you played?
Sunless Sea.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yes, Sunless Sea. That is a, again, roguelite inspired, but it is a very narratively driven game. A lot of story in that game. If you love the idea of an under the ground ocean that's all green and Cthulhu is involved somewhere, in some way, and it has a very weird world that's based on weird English mythology called Fallen London, then you need to play Sunless Sea. It's pretty great. And of course, people are mentioning FTL. FTL is not a roguelike, but it has certain inspirations. Yeah, it is a roguelite. Really?
And
if
it's
great. It is. It's a great game.
That's my endorsement.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. It only has small elements of the roguelike genre in it, though. It is not a roguelike. So
I like... It's pretty cool that a game defined a genre and then was named... The genre was named after the game.
Rogue. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, they used to call FPS Doom clones.
Clones, yeah. I was going to say that. God, yeah.
Until the genre became so fleshed out that they had they came up with a real term for it.
Well, MOBAs were Dota.
Dota-likes, yeah. I mean, I still call them Dota-likes. Honestly, I don't like MOBA. I don't think MOBA is a good term.
MOBA, it doesn't really apply. It's not...
It means nothing. Multiplayer online battle arena. That could be bloody anything.
Quake, it's the most generic thing in the world.
Unreal Tournament is a multiplayer online battle arena. Is it the same genre?
I'm playing Pokken later. That's a multi-online battle arena.
Yeah, it's a battle arena and it's online and it's multiplayer. So it's a MOBA. No, it isn't. That's why MOBA is a bad word. I don't like it. Really, it was invented by Riot because they didn't want to be compared to their competition anymore, so they've made up a new genre. Like, nope. Not gonna fall for that.
Mm-mm. Another game I played this week is Sheltered.
Yes, I have heard about this. Tell me about Sheltered.
So Sheltered is, obviously, most people have played Fallout Shelter.
Yes, which is a bad game.
Sheltered is a more realistic and way harder version of Fallout Shelter.
It wouldn't take much to be harder, considering that game literally has no gameplay in it.
You start with a family of four in a bunker, and you have to build beds, toilets, showers. You have to clean it. You have to stop your people getting food poisoning. You have hazmat suits. You have to try and fix your water and vents on the surface in hazmat suits. It's very, very difficult in terms of food and water management. You have to send your people on expeditions to find food and find parts, like build a freezer so you can like hunt. You can only collect water when it rains, so you have to build up silos.
I hunt with a freezer
and
constantly.
Wait for a rain
day. It's
the
most effective way.
If you like that kind of game, it's definitely the most satisfying and difficult version of this game type.
I was looking for something like that because Fallout Shelter, while it is a nice flashy thing, is a clicker.
Yeah, it's really good. You send people out on expeditions, and they have a chance of bumping into other survivors, and then you can choose to either trade with them, recruit them, or some of them will just be crazy and will try and fight you and can injure and kill your survivors. So you have to actually arm your survivors when they go out to protect them from like other people and bears and stuff. You'll also get people like coming to your shelter trying to seek refuge or trade. So there's like tons of different elements in it that actually makes it a game, instead of just like Fallout Shelter, which is just like click a dude, assign him somewhere, you've played the game. This is like very, there's a lot of people management.
That reminds me of This War of Mine.
I was just about to say that.
Yeah, very much so. But like, yeah, I really enjoyed it. It was very difficult to start once on my like fourth playthrough, I kind of started to get the hang of it and stuff. And managed to build a freezer and make a snare trap to get fucking deer. And
did you hunt deer with the freezer? Was that the most effective way, do you think?
Sorry?
Did you hunt the deer with the freezer? Because you said you really needed the freezer to go hunting, so I assumed you were using it as a weapon.
So basically, you can only have meat from things you hunt if you have a freezer. But to get a freezer,
you've got to kill them with the freezer.
To get a freezer, you have to find a motor out in the wilderness. So I have to, like, go to the towns and just pray that I find a motor somewhere in the towns.
How do you hunt the motor?
Like, chances are you starve by day four. Like, it's, like, super hard.
How difficult is it to hunt the motor? Do they tend to run away at first sign of trouble?
Yeah. Yeah, they do.
That's incredible.
I just want to point out, it's super convenient for the apocalypse that it only affects humans and not animals or anything else.
Yeah, the deer seem pretty fine. That's...
Yeah, the animals are fine. From the radiation, it can eat them. But the humans, no.
Yeah, I mean, eating irradiated meat sounds totally healthy. That shouldn't be a problem at all.
I love it, because, like, you have to equip people with a gas mask to send them out, or they get radiation poisoning. But, like, you can just... There's deer just up there chilling, and you're like, oh, I'm just going to eat you.
Yeah, that's all you need to deal with radiation poisoning, by the way, a gas mask. That's all you need. It's fine. Everything else, not a big deal.
Aside from the lack of realism... It is.
We are criticizing the realism of this. But you can go hunting with a freezer, which is great.
Yeah, it's incredibly satisfying for that genre of game. And if you're into that kind of thing, I'd highly recommend it.
Hunt wild motors in the wilderness. Ooh.
You say that now, but wait till you find a fucking motor, TB, and you're going to be in my boat.
It's hard to catch a haggis. Real hard. They're squirrely. Sneaky little things.
They are.
They are.
I only say this because I know some might believe. And that's fun. Sheltered, yes, that's available on Steam right now. I do intend to play it. It looks like it might be my bag. We will see if that is true. I hope so.
The other game I've been playing a lot of, which I'll let you talk about because you have also been playing it, is Indeed. Battleborn.
Yeah, Battleborn. So here's the problem with the MOBA genre is that this isn't one, but people think it is because that bloody applies to everything. Battleborn. I don't think in recent memory I have seen a game that has either just been marketed as poorly or has been completely written off by people.
That's its biggest problem. Absolutely. Yeah.
It is incredible how much people either do not know about this game or think the game is terrible without having played it. And I'm going to go to bat for it and say every last one of you is wrong about this game. You have no idea what you're talking about. Let me explain why. I'm going to make a big video on this later, but let me use this as a sounding board. Battleborn. Some people think that Battleborn is very much an Overwatch clone or a TF2 clone, or it's a traditional Dota-style or League of Legends game. It is none of those. Battleborn is by Gearbox. It's by the Borderlands guys. And it is primarily multiplayer, but also has a big single-player mode as well. First-person shooter. But it is a first-person shooter with PvE aspects, so it has creeps and minions and bosses and stuff like that. So in Battleborn, you choose a Battleborn. Don't ask me why they're called that. And that Battleborn has a few weapons and usually has a couple of different abilities. And as you go into the game, you are given the ability to level up what's called a Helix Point, which is basically a skill point. And every time you level up at a maximum of level 10, which you do in-game, it lets you pick another one. So it's kind of like Heroes of the Storm in that way. You get to pick from a couple of mutually exclusive talents. But that's not really the core aspect of the game. The game is absolutely a first-person shooter. You are given first-person shooter guns or melee weapons. And you fight both the creeps, the minions, and you fight the enemy team. And there's a few different game modes. One of them is called Incursion, which is the biggest game mode. And Incursion, you have to destroy two big, highly obnoxious sentry robots that constantly insult you as you try and kill them.
Oh my god, the robot killed me yesterday, and then on the death screen, it like wound its middle finger up at me, and then just like walked away.
Yep.
I was like, are you serious?
The game has a very Gearbox sense of humor. Very, very, very Borderlands. It's got some great stuff in it. One of the characters that I played is a combination of two characters. She is a teenage girl who somehow has some kind of shadow spirit that's attached to her. And the shadow spirit really doesn't want anything to do with her. But they're stuck together for some reason. And she makes the stupidest quotes. So she came up, she's like, she gives the names of the characters. I'm just going to make the names up because I can't actually remember what they're called. It's like, Aeris and Shadow, teenage detectives. And he yells like, we are not detectives! Like, he just doesn't want anything to do with her, but they're stuck together for whatever lore reason.
The voice acting's really good.
The voice acting is excellent. A lot of the Borderlands voice actors are in it. Tiny Tina is a character in that game, although she's something else. There was a character who is literally a luchador Mexican wrestler. And the whole point of the game is, in that mode anyway, is to destroy the sentry bot. To destroy the sentry bot, you need to make sure that your minions get to the sentry bot so they can break its shield. And then you go and damage it. If you engage it on your own, you get blown up and the game insults you for it. As you do it, you level up, you are able to acquire shards, which is an in-game currency that lets you build stuff on the map. So you can build deployables like a healing station or a turret. As you do that, you level up. So the game encourages you to build shit because it gives you experience for doing that. So you can build defenses and upgrade defenses. And of course, you're fighting with the other dudes as well. And you're fighting with a character who is kind of like an Overwatch character or a Team Fortress 2 character or something like that. And they're all unique. There's one that has two, like, energy blades, and is, I refer to him as Edgelord. That's not his real name, but he's very upset about everything, so I assume he's a, very much a 4chan poster. And he has these two swords. He can do, like, a kind of cross attack, which is a ranged attack. His ultimate is a spinning whirlwind, which knocks people up in the air. You can air juggle with him. You can do combos. There is a character called Marquis, who is a robot with a bowler hat. He has owls. Everyone is fond of owls, and he sends the owls out to attack. And the owls will laser in on somebody and go and attack them. And he also has a sniper rifle, which has a very old scope on it. You know, very very much old-timey steampunk. And he's basically a feat sniper. You were playing a girl who is a French kind of lady.
She's a French scientist.
French scientist.
She's French, she loves fencing, so she has 7 fencing rapiers.
And she uses the power of her mind to attack with them. So they're floating around her and she fires them off.
Yeah.
So the game mode is very similar to, it's a bit Titanfall. Titanfall is probably the best way to describe it. If you play Titanfall's game mode where you had to deal with the creeps and stuff, it's kind of like that. It's also very much like,
I feel like they take aspects of everything. Like,
yes.
You have resource collection, you have PvE, like you kill mobs and then you like recruit them to join your creep wave.
Yes.
You have tower defense where you build towers, and then you have this PvP arena element where you're trying to kill the other players too. So like it literally has everything and can't be compared to anything, which is why I don't get why people are saying it's like an Overwatch clone.
Because they're making assumptions based on like trailers and things like that after not having actually played it. It's also important to note this game being a full $60 game has a full story campaign. Which is something that people have been saying, oh, I wish Overwatch had for a while. This has a full-on story. So I played with Dodger last night. We played the story mode in 2-player. They're releasing the story as episodes over time. And we played, like, episode 2 or something like that. And we landed on a planet, and our ship crashed because it was piloted by someone that wasn't paying attention. So everyone was upset about that. It has the Borderlands sense of humor. We infiltrated this base. We hunted down these enemies. We found the shield generators to disable. And halfway through, this giant robot drops in, and we've got to help the robot. And we can upgrade the robot, and the robot's constantly talking. And the robot's like, I'm going to hack this door. And he's like, I'm too lazy to hack this door. I'm just going to blow it up. So he blows the door up, and you have to defend the robot. There's a giant boss fight at the end, which had, it's actually on the screen right now. It had like 4 different phases. It took us to an entire, we were literally in space at one point, fighting weird creep waves. And then we came back, and then there was this tiny little bubble that became this world-ending energy thing. We had to blow up 4 things first before the bubble killed everybody. And we got loot drops, we got power-ups, and what we did in the story mode actually upgraded our characters for the multiplayer. Which I thought was really cool.
Mm.
And we've had a blast playing it. We've been playing it the last week in the press beta, and we have been enjoying the shit out of this game. It's got a lot of game modes. It's got a lot of variety in terms of characters. It has a loot system that doesn't suck, which is good.
They've got free content that's already announced that's coming.
Yep.
It's that, dude, it's like one of those games where very rarely will I say a game is worth its $60 price tag, but I feel like this game is legit worth the $60 price tag.
It's got a lot of shit in it. Like, people have been complaining for ages, I'm sick of multiplayer-only games. Okay, this game has a single-player campaign. Oh, it's $60. Yeah, because it has a single-player campaign and a multiplayer campaign and no microtransactions. So of course it's $60. I mean, that's the price it should be, right? They're like, it should be free! Oh, God damn it! Just flip the table! You know, the problem with making a game like that free is you end up with Paragon. And the problem that Paragon has is that it needs to monetize in some way, and the way it does it is through the world's worst equipment system. And this game has a good equipment system, so the way the gear works in this game is really cool. You can pick up to 3 pieces of gear to take with you into a match, and you never have to buy them if you don't want to. You spend your shards either on that equipment, which gives you some upgrades, or you spend it on building turrets and robots and things. And as you build turrets and robots, you gain experience. So it's actually a viable strategy where you don't get gear and you build robots instead because you get a level advantage over people.
Also, the thing about gear that I love is the stats on gear when you get gear is randomly rolled every time.
Yeah.
So you can actually just like get really good stuff because your gear just rolled well, or you can get like a super dud.
Sure.
Of a glove.
But the way they balance it really
the
well.
Items back to the shop too. So if you get equipment you don't like, you can sell it back and like get new stuff.
Yeah, basically as you win games, you get packs and you're like, oh god, you hated Paragon, why do you like this? Because it's completely different. In Paragon, all the packs that you get basically define your entire character. Gear in this, it doesn't define your character at all. It's a nice bonus, and you don't even have to actually buy it in-game. Because there's a viable strategy where you don't. You buy robots and defenses instead, and you level up, because as you buy the gear, you don't level up. If you buy robots and defenses, you level up. So you're more powerful than that dude because of that. And this gear is like 20% reload speed, or, you know, 10% damage. It's not character-defining. It's a bonus. It's a little bonus.
It strictly appeals to the PvP players. If you're a player that wants to just fight the other players, then you go for gear. But if you're not that kind of player and you want to like interact with the environment and help the team more, then you don't get equipment. You get like towels and stuff. It's just like there's an avenue for everyone.
The cool thing about that is you can do both. You can buy gear that makes towers cheaper.
Mm.
I've got some gear that when I build a tower for 30 seconds, I get faster reload speed after I built it. So I help the team and then I get a bonus, which is cool. And there's also gear with downsides and stuff like that. I mean, I'm going to do a video that probably explains that, because I probably just info dumped all over the place. Just like, hey, all this shit! But it's got a really cool character to it. All the characters are really interesting, and they have really great voice acting. They have a lot of character. I've said that word way too many times already. I need synonyms. Synonyms! Stuart, synonyms! Stats!
Elements?
Stuart, synonyms! Please!
Synonyms.
I need synonyms.
For what?
Character. Synonyms for character.
Synonym for character. How about...
I'm bleeding out, Ashens, help.
That's a hard one, isn't it?
You're on your own.
Yeah.
Personality.
Yeah.
I guess.
The personality of the characters there.
Flavor,
maybe. Distinctive voices.
Distinctive, yes. Distinctions, we like it.
Fleshed out.
Yeah.
Believable. Not like Piers Morgan.
Yes, perfect.
Wow.
There is no Piers Morgan in this game at all.
Nega Piers Morgan.
Nega Piers Morgan.
They are filled with their...
Negasonic Teenage Morgan.
Yes, there we go.
I would not watch that movie, actually. No. Yeah, So everything I've played of it... There are a couple of complaints. I'm not claiming it's perfect. Like, the screen is the most visually busy shit you have ever seen in your life. Ooh, there's so much color.
They've got to
cut that back.
It's worthy.
Oh
sure.
God, it's the so because it's like the Borderlands graphic style, but there's so much shit on the screen because you know in the big modes there's a lot of creeps, a lot of minions, a lot of explosions, a lot of shit going down. So it's like, what the hell is going on? I'm blind. That they've got to sort out, and also the gun models are way too big. They need to fix that too. There's some netcode issues. One of the characters I was playing, the teenage detective one, has an ability that sends her shadow out to grab somebody and bring them to them, which sounds great, because then you can wail on them, except when I grab them, half the time they disappear and reappear somewhere else, because the netcodes are not brilliant. So they definitely...
It's actually one of the things... I haven't played the game in the early access beta stuff, but I have played it at E3 and PAX and stuff, so it's only been little short bursts, but the one thing that I would say that I really, really noticed was that, besides it looking great and the characters being awesome, it's super busy. I've always come away being like, I don't know what just happened. Win or lose, I'm just like, all right, that was looked great. I don't know what the fuck happened on the screen, but it looked cool.
Takes a while to figure it out. There are. It depends on the game mode. Like the one they just introduced, the new game mode Meltdown, which is a much simpler mode where you are literally feeding a furnace that thinks it's a god, and it's like, feed me or I'll destroy the world. So you have to feed it robots,
and then is your own robots.
Yeah, your own robots. So you have to escort your minions to the furnace. He then eats them, and it's like, be reborn as three-ring binders, and things like that. It's like, this is fucking hilarious. But that mode is a lot simpler because there's a lot less shit going down. There's basically two lanes, there's not that many minions, it's not crazy. But Incursion, which is the big mode, is fucking insane. I think they definitely need to do something about that to make it more visually, not appealing, palatable is the word I'm looking for. Tolerable.
It looks visually appealing as is. That's not the problem. It's the fact that there's so much happening.
It's overload. Overwhelming. Visual overload. Think League of Legends, worse. And League of Legends is color vomit. This is maybe even worse than that. So that, I think, needs to be resolved. But I'm going to go to bat for fucking Battleborn. I'm sick to death of hearing the bullshit about Battleborn for people who haven't played it. It's good. It's original. It reminds me of Monday Night Combat, which was a really great game that none of you motherfuckers played, and you let it die, and I don't like you. So Battleborn is like Monday Night Combat. So maybe, you know, if that is your bag, then think about it.
I totally let that game die.
You did! You let it die. Super Monday Night Combat, same problem. You let that die too, although that had its own issues, but I love those games. Yeah, there you go. There's your Battleborn pitch. There'll be a full video coming later this week. Right now, me, Dodger, Strippin', Cry are playing it to death and having a shitload of fun. Also, the devs suck and we're better than them.
Damn!
We beat the devs. We whooped their ass.
We've beat them repeatedly. They even cheated. Like, after we beat them once, they brought in their level 100s and we beat them anyway.
They you can't pick the same character twice, but they could.
But they could.
They also just made themselves rank 100, so they had everything, and then they still lost.
That's super salty and amazing. Like, rank 100.
We beat them anyway. The interesting thing is that leveling up doesn't give you, an advantage per se, but as you level up, you unlock more characters. You also get more gear. Like, you can get up to, orange level legendary artifact gear, and you think, oh god, people with artifact gear are going to be the best. No, because the gear scales by cost. So if you've got a super good item, it costs a shitload to turn. You have to activate it.
You literally can't afford it for the first 10 minutes of the game.
Exactly.
The game's only 15 minutes long.
Yeah, so it's balanced. Like, they balanced it that way. There are literally items that cost no money that you can have in-game immediately if you like. So you pick based on how fast you think you can level up. If you take something that's too expensive and you don't get enough shards in-game, it's useless because you can never activate it. It's a genius piece of balance.
And you have to spend time farming, which means you're not helping the team because you're going farming crystals.
Yeah, you need to pick up crystals to get it. Yeah. There's a lot of really smart ideas in Battleborn. I'm all over it. I like it. It's going to fail because I like it.
The last game I played is Pokken, but, you know.
Yes, we'll get to that. We'll do Pokken after the break because we're actually, I think we need
I mean, Pokemon fighting game. We're done.
Oh, okay. There you go. Pokemon fighting game. Apparently Mewtwo, Shadow Mewtwo is overpowered. There you go. We'll be coming back after the break with the news and also the releases, and then we'll do some shameless plugging, because we'd really love you to go and watch our channels. You're watching the Co-optional Podcast with special guest Stuart Ashens. He will become a three-ring binder. We'll be right back. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Co-optional Podcast. You just heard the wonderful sounds of Dracula is Our Vampire, Vampire Killer by Jorito featuring BMC War Machine, which is on ocremix.org on the Vampire Variations Volume 3, which is, needless to say, based entirely on Castlevania. And it's
that
fucking...
That was a bigger mouthful than this, crisp.
Yep. Not a bigger mouthful than the 5 Jaffa Cakes I just ate, but I will say that that album is amazing! And you should probably go and have a look at it. And it's free. That's always good. Like that. Love free music. Always great. Cool. Let's talk about... We were going to talk about Pokken, but I think you've pretty much said all that needs to be said about Pokken, right?
Pokemon. Yeah. Pokemon it's, it's a really fun fighter where your Pokemon, it has a three-dimensional phase, and then it has a two-dimensional phase.
I'm interested in on that basis, because that's interesting and weird.
Oh, it's really cool. So you have specific moves that force you into a different phase.
Okay.
And so the projectile characters obviously want to keep it in field phase where they can shoot projectiles in a three-dimensional space. And then the fighting type characters want to try and get in and force it into the dual phase, which is the 2D phase, because then they can get their Street Fighter-esque combos in. And so like it's like a constant balance in the matches between trying to like switch the phases, which is really cool. It's very unique for a fighting game, but I'm enjoying it.
That sounds cool. Like, how accessible is it? Like, do I need to know 5,000 combos in order to even by?
The combos are really, really straightforward, and they have a really good tutorial that teaches you all the combos in the tutorial just off the bat. And the combos are very straightforward. It's like up X, down X, or YYY into a cancel, which is a cancel simply pressing another button, and then XXX. Like, there's no quarter circles or any of that kind of shit. It's just a direction and a button. In terms of the entry level for a fighting game, it's really good. But then there's high level mechanics like you can counter, and then there's counter canceling where you go to like counter, kind of like an EX in Street Fighter.
Okay.
You go to counter, and then you can dash back and all this kind of stuff. But yeah, it's really cool.
Nice.
And they've got like a really good rank system. The net code is very good. There's a really good single player league thing too as well.
I've been watching Shofu play a lot of that with Pikachu.
Can I play Psyduck?
He's the number one Pikachu in America.
You cannot play Psyduck. Here's the thing. You can't play Squirtle. You can't play Psyduck. There is no Meowth. It is not a game I care about. However,
what kind of game doesn't have Meowth in it? I mean, really?
So it's all the most popular Japanese Pokemon. So there's like any Pokemon in there. There's like
Pikachu rubbish.
Libre. There's Pikachu Libre TB, which is Pikachu but a wrestler with wrestling moves.
Sold. Two copies.
Also, there's Machamps in it as well, who's basically a wrestler.
Also, there's a chandelier. Out of all the characters they picked a chandelier.
Do you get to swing?
The chandelier is fucking
from the
broken.
Chandeliers.
Like, everyone.
From the chandeliers.
But yeah, go if you want to see like the basics of it. Shofu has some really good videos out right now that are him just like taking on guys and explaining everything he's doing. And it explains even when they try to counter him, like there's a lot of cool abilities where they can set up like pillars to make it so if you touch any of them, so you have to like change your fighting style. It's really cool.
You get two support Pokemon that you can take into a fight with you.
Oh,
so
sick.
If you're against a ranged like projectile using Pokemon, you can tag in these support Pokemon that do an attack and leave. And so, like,
is one of them Psyduck?
No,
fuck.
No.
But like, yeah, if you're against a ranged Pokemon and you're a close range one, you can bring out a ranged support that shoots a beam and like lets you get in.
But yeah, can the support character swing from the chandelier? No,
they can't.
What fucking game is this, really?
Fuck.
How does this 3D mode work? Is it a bit like Psychic Force or Powerstone? Or
I hope it is.
Kind of. So, like, basically, the fight takes place in a dome, like a force field, and so you have like the whole area of the force field. Your moveset like changes when you're in field mode, and then so you still have like a grab, but like you basically move three dimensionally to try and fight each other. And whoever gets knocked down first. Goes down and then the phase changes and the other person gets like a bonus to their EX meter, their ultra meter. And all the Pokemon have like a burst phase, which is where they can transform and then they get like an ultra. So you can do like really cool ultras and stuff too.
It's really cool to watch. It reminds me...
It's so fun to watch.
Yeah, the new changes they made to Street Fighter V, like just the background is really exciting. Even... it's just weird things to look at in the background of like Pokemon trainers, and you're like, what the hell is going on?
There's one map which is called the Magikarp Festival, and it's just hundreds of Magikarp just flopping around in the background of this fight while you're trying to fight some other guy.
Is Magikarp a playable character?
No, but it is a support character.
It's a support character. Oh, right, there we go. Excellent. I'm gonna swing from the chandeliers with Magikarp.
And then I think there's like randomly on a 10-second delay, it just comes out of nowhere and like slaps them.
Yes.
And so I was watching the stream and some guy just forgot about it, and then it got him at a crucial moment. It was like, fucking Magikarp!
I assume you can buy this on the eShop nonsense, and so I don't have to get it with a disc in a box.
You can buy it on the Wii U store.
All right, and I buy it on the Wii U store.
Public
play
buying
it right
at
after.
TV? Yes.
What? I don't want to leave the house. Is that possible?
It's very fun. Great. I'm going to stream it right after this. So
that sounds like super fun. Another game that you mentioned, because Ashens, you were mentioning like Power Stone and Psychic Force. It sounds a bit like Virtual On.
Oh, God. I loved Virtual. In fact, I've got a friend in Japan who's just sourced me the 360 version, which was never released over.
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Which apparently will play, you know, without any import problems. Yep.
Yeah, because I believe it was, I can't remember, was that a conversion of Oratorio Tangram, which was the Dreamcast sequel?
I believe so, yeah, with some enhancements, I think.
Yes. That game is god-tier good. If no one has played Virtual On before, give it a shot. It's a 3D battle arena. And you pick a robot. It's kind of a behind-the-shoulder view. And instead of it being a fighting game, you're in a full 3D arena, kind of side-dashing and air-dashing, and you've got like three weapons, and you're trying to beat the shit out of the other robot. And it's got amazing robots. It's also known as Cyber Troopers. There's some 60 FPS footage of the 360 version I have right here, actually. Oh, that was Temjin, I think. That's the guy with the sword. I used to play Viper 2, who had I can't remember, what did Viper 2 have? She was a kind of purple robot, really, really agile.
Oh, the one that fired hearts. That sort of stuff.
She was someone different. That wasn't Viper 2. But there is a character that fires heart beams.
That was white and pink. Yeah. Gosh, that's so long. I used to play the original on Saturn.
Yes, the original did come out on Saturn. I played the shit out of that. Oratorio Tangram was a Dreamcast game and was excellent. And of course, there was the arcade version that had two. So the control method for this game was very unusual. The arcade version had two sticks. And you controlled it with these two sticks, and moves would involve you pulling the sticks apart at the same time or pushing them together and forward. It was almost like controlling a mech, I would assume. And it was really unusual. You could actually buy the home version, but it was like $250 for these sticks. So most people didn't buy them. But it was a kick-ass game. And actually, if Pokken is even close to that, then I want in.
It was developed by Bandai Namco, so it has that kind of, like, all their kind of fighting games in the 3D environment.
Yes.
Has that kind of model. Mm. Yeah. I'm fucking loving it. It's so much fun.
I dig it. That sounds great. I'm going to buy it right after the show. God, this show's costing me a lot of money as well. Now I know how you feel, Stuart. Jesus. Yeah, you see the gameplay right here, where you're behind the character. That's the one with the heartbeam, actually, who's playing right now. She's fighting the boss, Jagarande, at the moment, who is this giant motherfucker. And it's a case of air dashing and trying to lock on and trying to dodge incoming fire. Line of sight is important. You can hide behind cover. You can charge an ultimate. You can melee as well. It's pretty kick-ass. It's a really good game. I wish they'd bring out another one.
It does. The 3D filmer does play like this.
It does? Oh. Mm-hmm. Oh.
Yeah, exactly like this. Like, you're locked onto the enemy and you're kind of like dodging projectiles from each other and stuff.
Fuck. This is what I wanted. Now all I need is a new Power Stone, and I'm going to be happy.
Oh my god, Power Stone was my fucking bae.
Fuck.
My childhood, my whole childhood.
I miss Power Stone so very much. It makes no sense that there isn't another one.
That is weird, actually. It's just one of those things that's totally disappeared, isn't it?
And it was like the biggest seller on the Dreamcast.
Yeah. Never enjoyed the second one much. They'd sort of changed some of the fundamentals. I never quite enjoyed it. But
I loved it.
First one was fantastic.
Mm. I'm in two minds as to which was the best one. Because the first one, I think, as a fighting game with fighting mechanics, was probably the better of the two. And I also say stage design was a bit more varied. But Power Stone 2 had four player. Power Stone 2 had a ton of loot drops. So there's like over 200 weapons. I remember trying to desperately get the tuna fish to drop, and it would never drop. You had to craft items. There was like 12 versions of the shotgun in that game. It's like, here's a shotgun. Now
the
three.
Item crafting was so good.
5-barrel, 7-barrel, 9-barrel, 11-barrel, 11-barrel free shotgun, 13-barrel fire shotgun, etc., etc. And you can get all sorts of shit like that. The one thing I liked and was also the downfall, I think, of Power Stone 2 is that every level had a ton of interactive elements and phases, but that meant there were only 5 levels, whereas original Power Stone had a shitload more than that.
Mm.
So I think there's ups and downs. They're both really good. I think
the favorite item was the scooter that you could ride into people.
Yes, Absolutely, you could.
And you just fuck them up.
That was amazing. I remember the battleship level where you were fighting over submarines, and the submarines would submerge dynamically during the match. So yeah. it's a principle that was picked up by Smash Brothers later, where they'd have the changing stages. But Power Stone did it first and was way better at it because you could get in a turret, you could grab part of the stage and hit somebody with it.
You could get in a turret, and someone had to break the turret to get you out.
Yeah, you could swing from a pole that was in the middle of the map. Or if you're a stronger character, you rip the pole out of the ground and hit them with it. And it depended on whether or not you were strong. There was also a chef who was a dinosaur.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
And his special ability was like he had the pot.
Giant pot.
The giant pot. And it just fucked everyone up.
I must have this. Yes, Tyrannosaurus Chef. Pot. He was called Gourmand. He was now I'm just in a giant nostalgia trip now. The fucking game was so good.
I want new Power Stone, I want new Darkstalkers.
Yeah, a new Darkstalkers is coming. That we know.
What?
Yeah. Yeah, I believe there is a new Darkstalkers on the way. If I recall correctly, except it looks like they might have cancelled it. Fuck.
Yeah.
Oh god damn it. Yeah, because they I thought they'd announced. Capcom. Yeah, they cancelled it in 2014. Fuck. Mm. But apparently Ono-san is striving to get a new Darkstalkers as of 2016. So yeah, Yoshihiro Ono wants to make a new Darkstalkers. He just doesn't think it's gonna sell.
Yeah, that's always the hard one, isn't it? It just certainly doesn't have the impetus of something like Street Fighter behind it, does it?
It does not, no. It does not.
Oh my god, that huge Dr. Erode, the boss in Power Stone 2. It was just like that super ugly dude holding the gem.
Yeah, I remember that guy. The boss fights were really cool because they had weak spots.
The fight was the pharaoh with like the tree trunk legs. You had to like break his legs.
Gotcha. Giant pharaoh robot, yeah.
So good.
Oh my god, it was brilliant. Yeah, but they brought it out on the PSP, which was a weird format for it. It's like this screen is far too small.
Chaos Tower or something.
Yeah, the game was so again very visually busy, especially with four player. It zoomed out to the point where on a very small screen, you could barely see anything. So it was not an ideal PSP game. But
to be fair, few were.
Yeah, PSP was not an amazing platform for most titles, but. There was axes and the fucking... This level is the temple level where there was a one-armed bandit where you could roll the wheels and get a bonus. Or explode.
My god, yeah.
Spikes everywhere, rolling boulders. There were mini-games, too. Like you could actually, I think it's phase three of the temple has you running away from boulders against everybody else.
And that guy was basically Goku, and his special was a spirit bomb.
Yes. Yeah, that guy was awesome. I want to skip forward to that phase because that phase was awesome. There we go. This is the boulder phase. So you could grab people and throw them into the boulder, and the first person through the door got through with full HP, and everyone else took damage in the next phase.
Everyone else got hit. Yeah. It was great.
And you had to try and steal the power stones from each other. If you collected three power stones, you basically went Super Saiyan. You got skateboards. See, the skateboards are literal weapons in this game.
Skateboard was amazing. Yeah, you could just skate ahead of everyone.
Oh, fuck. Modern gaming is terrible.
This shit was so good.
We don't... Why don't we have another one of these fucking things? This is perfect. You can play this online easily. Guy's a rocket launcher on his arm. There's a fucking giant bomb and a one-armed bandit in the corner. You can hit people with a shield or another person. There's a pot. That's a flamethrower, I think. Ah, oh, Jesus. It's a lead pipe. I'm really sad now.
Don't worry, because Pokken's great.
Okay, if Pokken is even close, okay.
I mean, it's not close to Powerstone, but it's great.
Fuck. I want Powerstone back. Why can't we have it?
Why did the Dreamcast have to die?
Why did the Dreamcast have to die?
Why did Sega have to give up on their dreams?
Why did Sega have to become awful?
Everybody was waiting for that PS2 with its amazing realistic graphics, and then it came out and was kind of like, this looks like the Dreamcast. Except not as good at the time, because I had a bloody VGA box for the Dreamcast, so it looked incredibly sharp. Except for about 20% of games that just wouldn't work with it.
Yes. That was really annoying. That was a bit annoying. Although I believe they came out once the Dreamcast had died and piracy was like really the only way you could play shit, you could get a self-launcher that actually had a VGA fix on it. So you could actually play.
Had a fucking Tamagotchi you could put in the controller and fucking like Final Fantasy feed your chocobo.
Love it.
Chow from Sonic Adventure, and like they take it out of the controller and like take it around with you. Oh fuck, it was so good.
And it had took three expensive batteries that lasted about 19 seconds.
About 19 seconds.
Fucking VMUs. The design of that controller, the way that for some stupid reason the cable came out of the bottom and it had a clip on the back so that you wouldn't get it tangled. But it had an analog stick. It was based on the Saturn 3D controller, which had a which was distributed with Knights, which was an
amazing
game.
They were ahead of their time, I'm telling you.
They really were. Oh god, I remember playing as Speed Devils on and it was Speed Devils Online. It was a hot rod racing game. And you had upgradable cars, but every time you went around a lap, something happened on the track. So there was a Hollywood map, and on I think lap three, giant dinosaur would come out and try and eat your car. It also had speed traps, so as you were going up, you had to break the speed limit for extra money, and then you get chased by the police and shit for doing that. There was a map where there were tornadoes, and there was a map where there were aliens that would take your car away. It was awesome. That was one of the happiest times of my life.
Someone said the Dreamcast was the John Kennedy of consoles.
Oh, God.
Die before it's time, full of promise.
Damn it!
Wow. Oh, my God. It's true, though.
Wacky races on Dreamcast.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Fuck, yes. I unlocked every... It took me ages to unlock the Mean Machine.
I played PSO as well, Phantasy Star Online.
Oh, my God.
I stopped playing Phantasy Star Online because of a hack that wiped my character, replaced it with a shittier one. This was when I learned to hate the Game Shark. The Game Shark was, of course, a kind of Game Genie-esque cheat hack thing. It was fine until people figured out you could use it for Phantasy Star Online and wipe people's characters remotely with it. And steal their shit.
They'd get into a lobby with you and they could, like, fuck with your character data.
Yep. I lost my full level character with all my good shit and got replaced with some level 20 jackass. I never played it again after that.
No, that's gonna.
I used to. I had like three friends who loved it too, so we would only play offline together as a group of four, and it was just perfect. Yeah, online was terrifying. You'd like see like a guy come into the lobby, but he wasn't a normal PSO sprite. He was like a Sonic or like a Tails, because he'd like changed his fucking sprite as a Game Shark, and everyone would just flee. Like
get the fuck out!
Like a guy with a gun. into a fucking food store, like everyone just like flees, tries to jump into private rooms, or like just alt F4s out the
literally
game.
Was
he
that,
just turns around,
yeah.
He's like, "Hi everyone," and we're just like, "Oh god, no, please."
That is exactly how it worked. Some of them would try and bribe you as well. It's like, "Give me your items, or I will do this to you." And you couldn't do it. You couldn't do anything about it other than pull the plug. That was literally the safest thing to do was pull the network plug.
You have the Ethernet cable and just rip
it out. Yank it out. That was it.
Oh, good times. Fuck. Good times.
It was a good time, yeah. I remember getting my Dreamcast. It was on Christmas Day, and my dad was super pissed because he'd never bought me a console before. He bought me and my brother the Dreamcast. He got it with Sonic Adventure and the Sega Rally 2, and which was a pretty good like launch lineup. That wasn't bad. The problem is we got one of the ones that was bugged that reset every minute.
Oh,
he was fucking furious. Because, you know, they spent like £300 on this fucking console and it didn't work. He was pissed. I don't blame him.
I'm so sad that PSO2 is not going to get a Western release.
No.
I played it for a while, but couldn't understand the hieroglyphics that are Japanese language.
Those games, I don't know. I played Phantasy Star Online a few years ago. I think I played like the GameCube version and it didn't age well.
No. No, they do not.
As an MMO, it's very basic. The combat system is also real basic, and there's not a lot of content.
But we've always got Phantasy Star Universe, or whatever it was called.
Yeah. Jesus Christ. Fuck.
That was like one of those games that came out for 360 and was £5 within about 8 seconds.
Oh my god, it was. Yeah, like it went out as a new release at fucking $7.99 and then was reduced to $5.
God.
And then it was so bad because it had like a 15 pounds monthly subscription attached to it as well. So you'd boot it up and it would be you had to buy and pay for an account to play. Yeah.
That's not, well, yeah. The first, you'd probably want a decent game attached for that, really, wouldn't you?
Yeah, you really would.
You were saying, Ashen, sorry, before that?
Yeah, famously they had Dreamcast keyboards turned up in Poundland. Just loads of the bloody things. But they also, for a short period, because they went almost immediately, they had the Dreamcast arcade sticks, which are some of the nicest home controllers going. Nice. And I always wish I'd picked one up, but I was in a situation where, well, I've already got one, but it's like, freaking quid, my God, but I could not sort of get it home for about 3 days or something, so I didn't buy it. And to this day, I kick myself for not getting that second Dreamcast arcade stick.
You would have carried it around for 3 days if you'd have known. Yeah.
They're probably worth at least £1 billion on eBay by now. Never mind. Such is life.
Yeah, pretty much. I miss the Dreamcast terribly. It was really, really good machine with a lot of great games. Even its launch lineup was actually really good. I mean, Powerstone was in it, for one thing. Yeah. I think it was like Sonic Adventure, Sega Rally 2, which was good.
Ready to Rumble was one of the...
That was a good game. I liked Ready to Rumble Boxing. That was really fun.
I bought that on day of release. Did nothing for me. I couldn't get on with that.
I thought it was all right.
Ashens, you would have made a ripe old $65 if you'd have kept that arcade stick.
Damn! I could have bought however much that's worth in pounds.
You could have bought Battleborn.
It's 50 pounds. You could have had 50 pounds.
My God. I'll never see the likes of that money again.
Never. Oh, dear. Take yourself until your dying day.
Dynamite Cop 2 was another launch one.
Yes, Dynamite Cop 2. It was a shame Dynamite Cop 2 was not like Die Hard Arcade. Dynamite Cop with the two-player, because that was great. Like, Dynamite Cop on Sega Saturn was the logical successor to Streets of Rage. A grandfather clock was a fucking weapon in that game. Yeah. You could pick up a grandfather clock and beat the shit out of people with it. What else? Trill Salon. Yeah, the penguin racing game. That was a thing. Toy Commander. How good was Toy Commander? That was a game where you get to play a bunch of different military toys, and there were a bunch of different levels surrounded, so you could like be a plane or a train or a giant dinosaur and all this sort of thing. Sega Rally was obviously great. Sega Bass Fishing with the fishing controller. Can't beat that.
God, yeah. And you could use the fishing controller in
Soul Calibur.
Soul Calibur, yes, of course. It was one as a really simple motion control that didn't work properly.
Yeah, it was busted and hilarious. Yeah. It was absolutely what you should be using. Expendable, which was a pretty good top-down kind of twin stick before they had twin stick.
Oh, yes.
Some of the chat said Choo Choo Rocket.
Choo Choo Rocket!
Oh, God.
The story I still have my copy of Choo Choo Rocket given away free.
I have one Dreamcast game that's still mint condition, and it is Shenmue and Shenmue 2.
Those are worth a fucking fortune in
condition sealed copies of both.
Yeah, they are worth a fortune. The story of Choo Choo Rocket is a story worth telling. Because, which that's a word you'll never hear again.
Versus Superman versus Choo Choo Rocket.
Versus Choo Choo Rocket. Choo Choo Rocket, incidentally, had the best fucking Japanese commercial that I've ever seen. I'm going to play it for you. It is 16 seconds long. You're going to get sound. It's going to be wonderful. And then I will tell you the story of what happened with Choo Choo Rocket in Europe, because it's a bit of a weird one. Because that was supposed to be a commercial game, and it ended up not being one. So this is Choo Choo Rocket. This is the 16-second advert that was played in Japan.
I like it.
There we go. You've experienced 16 glorious seconds of Choo Choo Rocket's song with a banjo involved. It is the fucking best. So the weird story about Choo Choo Rocket is that it was supposed to be a commercial release. And it was delayed so very, very long that it was supposed to be released like years before that they actually gave it away for free in the UK yeah, to promote.
It came with the console.
It actually, they sleeve. Actually, they sent it to you.
Yes, they would, did.
Yeah, they sent it. It's
they
like
sent
a,
it with a keyboard, letter. Didn't they? Or is it if you bought the keyboard, they sent it to you? I can't remember the setup now.
I think so.
Yes, so what something. Happened was, it did
it
really
like
well
a
in Japan.
Slip.
Yeah, it did really well in Japan in like 1999. And then they're like, we're going to bring it to America and Europe. And it slipped and slipped and slipped. And they released a demo of it that was really popular. And then it slipped again. And they didn't, they released it in America, but they didn't release it in Europe for like fucking months. And then finally, in June, they gave it for free to everybody who was subscribed to Dream Arena, which is the online gaming service for Dreamcast. They got it free. So they bundled it with their browser, which was called Dream Key, and you got it for free in the post. So randomly one day, Choo Choo Rocket arrives, and I'm like, this is the best! I just got a free game. And it's amazing! It's a really fun, real-time battle puzzle game that
is
still
awesome. There's a problem with Choo Choo Rocket. It's when Choo Choo Rocket came to me, I was playing Powerstone. And that shit never got played. Played it like twice. And I was like, I'm gonna play some more Powerstone.
I just love the fact that it was one of the best online games for the Dreamcast. It basically demonstrated that the Dreamcast could do online multiplayer and that it would be good. Cause it was awesome. You jumped online, you played against people, and it was fun, it was easy, it didn't lag, it was reliable. But so people loved it, and that really pushed the online aspect of the Dreamcast until, of course, the Dreamcast killed itself, or Sega did. It was part of a strategy to market the Dreamcast and market the online play. And that's Dreamcast.
Thinking about it, it was impressive. It, well, I mean, it was all, you know, just this built-in modem on it. What was it, 56K, presumably?
I think it may have been 33.6, but...
Good God. And yes, it worked.
Yeah, it did. There was actually a broadband adapter available for that thing later on, which did help a lot.
They go for a fortune, those.
Yeah, they do. Yeah, they do. It's it was a decent online service, honestly. I believe you can get Choo Choo Rocket on iOS and Android, by the way, if you want to keep playing it.
Oh.
It is available. They did release a version for mobile. I would love to see another one because that game was super fun. Cool. That's our little Dreamcast in memoriam, I suppose.
RIP. Yeah, brethren.
We literally wanted to talk more about that than we did about this week's news. I don't think there even is anything this week that I give two snots about.
Oh, the Xbox Dark Souls thing? We touch on that?
Can if you like. Although it sounds like Stuart had something.
Do you know about it?
No, far right. You said Dark Souls. Now I'm interested. Like this.
So Dark Souls was released in Japan yesterday.
Yes. Sorry, I'm with you. Yep.
People were making Japanese Xbox accounts and trying to buy the game Japanese. The Xbox would register the region they were in, realize they're in US, would translate the Japanese version of Dark Souls to the US version for them. And so people were getting the full US version of Dark Souls 3 weeks before release yesterday. Because Xbox fucked it up. And this is like not the first time that they've done this. They did it for Blood Bowl as well. They released like all of the DLC that the company had that they were waiting on, like when the game came out. Like they've done it quite a few times in the last year, but like it's like they've done it enough that it could, like it feels like, and it's only on cross-platform games too. It feels like it's almost deliberate. Like they're like leaving these things in knowing that it's going to help sales, because it's just like so fucking dumb. Like, how can you do that? And the reason the game's not coming out for 3 weeks in America is because of like tax and licensing, because the tax year starts in April in America. So it's like,
it's an interesting reason.
It's a big fuck up. But
have they closed the loophole now?
I have no idea. So I have no idea at all. But no.
I'm going to wait for PC. I want that 60 frames per second.
Joy. I know.
You do. Well, I played it yesterday at 60. It's, you know, it's always going to be better at 60. There's not even a question about that. The PC version is fine. I don't care about the embargo because I'm not going to be reviewing the game. So I'm not much of a Dark Souls fan. I'm not going to waste my time doing that because no one cares. Here's the problem with Dark Souls, right? Nobody cares about my opinion about Dark Souls. So there's no point in me giving it. Because either you don't like Souls or you've already pre-ordered it.
Mm.
My opinion doesn't matter to you in a fucking any universe. And you know what? That's fine. I just won't bother then. You know, it's... I'd rather play... You know, I like the Soul series. I admire the Soul series for what it is. And I just... I don't want to spend my time playing it, really. I'll probably do a little report that says, hey, is the PC version good? I mean, it's okay. Done. You know, it works. Mostly. I'd recommend a controller.
Mostly?
There was mostly. A bug we found out yesterday that is related to the windowed mode versus full screen in that game. When we first started... The full screen mode had so many frame drops in the options menu that it literally disconnected me from the online service because I was lagging too much. And in doing that, and moving on to the character creation, it was running at about a frame a second, and it took about 5 seconds to move something on the menu. That was fixable by hitting Alt-Tab and going into windowed mode. And if you went back after that, you were fine. Outside of that, the only thing is really just use a controller because the menu is just as awful as it was in the previous versions. And if you navigate it with mouse and keyboard, you're going to be thinking, what the hell's going on? So there's that. But otherwise, it's a Souls game. The thing about Souls games is that everyone's made up their mind weeks, months before the game even comes out. So even if the game is the worst Souls game of all time, you've all pre-ordered it anyway. And which is
pre-order. No.
Stop pre-ordering video games.
Pre-order.
They're going to do it anyway. And then they're going to get salty that streamers and reviewers get it before them. I was like, it's not fair! What? What do you mean it's not fair? How the fuck? Review copies have been around for decades. And now you're suddenly complaining now? You're only complaining now because it's a game you wanted. What you should have done is not pre-order the damn game in the first place and waited for us to tell you whether or not it's any good. That's our job. If it sucks, thankfully it doesn't seem to, but if it sucks and you end up buying it, that's your own bloody fault. Don't do it. I'm like, why? I have 15 subscribers on YouTube. Why do I not have it? Because you didn't work to make any damn contacts. If you'd done that, you could have got it. I want people to just give me viewers on a platter. I want you to fuck off. You're lazy. This is new generation of millennial streamers, man. These entitled little millennials.
Generation of streamers.
The new
this is for like 8 minutes.
This is the quiet you. This is the third generation of streamers, and they're lazy.
Third generation.
My generation of streamers. Yeah. We scraped and we clawed and we pulled ourselves up by our virtual bootstraps, by our boot camps. If we're using macOS,
we had to go uphill both ways to stream, and by God, we liked it.
And by God, we liked it. It took
we
us.
We had to type all the ones and zeros individually.
Individually. Individually. Encode those frames. We didn't even have XSplit. What's this XSplit? It's this casual liberal nonsense, is what XSplit is. We had to beam our pictures directly via the internet, frame by frame, compositing them ourselves. What's encoding? What is compression? All these wonderful little things that these
damn
new.
Kids don't know how lucky they have it.
Damn
they
kids with their music. Know. And their stable streaming. Damn kids with their Twitch. Back in my day, it was called Justin. It had a real name. It realized what it was. It was a single Asian male. That's what it was. It was Justin. He realized he didn't have an identity crisis.
To get on his thing.
It was just in.
It was just in. Very nice. We like it. It's good. Seriously, though, if you want fucking review copies and streaming copies of a game, you've got to actually prove that you deserve it! So go and make contacts. Go and make content. Do something. It's like, I made a video 3 years ago. It has 10 views. Why don't I have a Dark Souls 3 copy? Maybe because you didn't fucking email them for one.
Review copies, you need the 3 C's, all right? You need content, you need contacts, you need cock gobbling, okay?
Yes.
Those are the three things you need.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Definitely need as many cock goblins as you can find.
Level 5 cock goblins.
Every studio.
And a white
you
worm
see
mask.
Behind me is all the cox goblins running around. Like, yes,
cox goblins.
I'm like, guys, I'm podcasting. They're back there. They're doing their magic. Give me contacts. Oh, yeah.
I didn't say goblins.
My pretties.
There's gobbling.
Cox goblins. Yeah, no, we all know what you're talking about. We're all aware.
Those cox goblins. Yeah, that's true.
Cox goblins. I lend them out to friends. They're very nice. They don't bite. They do laundry. They're good guys. They're good
I'll
guys.
Take one. I'll take 10. 10 cox, please. Yes. Mm.
So yeah, I didn't get a code. Yeah,
I'll sort you out. You see, you've got a seat. You've got a contact.
You've got a gobble TV's cock.
No, you don't.
To be fair, they probably wouldn't give you on the grounds. I wouldn't do anything with it other than secretly play it in my room and giggle to myself. So.
I mean, if I don't tell them that, they might be okay with it.
I mean, here's the thing.
I would recommend not saying
that bit out.
Yeah, I wouldn't cut that out in post. It's fine.
Oh, dear. Imagine we laugh about multiple generations of streamers and stuff. There are people watching my YouTube channel who are younger than my YouTube channel.
That's amazing,
isn't
it?
The channel's 10 years old.
10 years old,
like 8 and 9 year old.
Yeah, all right. Yeah, I guess that's a possible thing. I don't know why that seemed crazy. Like, what?
I think half of it is because I'm worried because I swear too much and they're teaching the kids bad words. You should be 13 or 15 or 16, depending
on
the territory.
You should be right on age of 13 before you start.
Yes.
I mean, to be fair, you're supposed to be 13 to have a YouTube account. You're not technically allowed one before then.
Yeah, that is our excuse.
So quit it. Yep, quit it. We put strong language warnings on our stuff for a reason, damn it. We take no responsibility for your bullshit.
I prefer your children learn to swear from me, honestly. If someone's going to teach them, I prefer it was me.
Yeah. Cox goblins. Yeah, that's Cox what goblins. We wanted to learn.
Cox goblins. You have to loan me a couple of those.
I got a few. I got a few with your name on it.
I'll pick them up tonight.
I got some cocks with your name on it. What did
I'll bring up Superman. Give you a little.
Yeah, bring a couple of cocks goblins to Superman. I'll take them home.
Really enjoyed co-optional podcast tonight. Hashtag cock goblins.
Cock. That's not how it's spelled. Later. No. We meant something entirely different. Holy shit.
So, did everybody see the potential leaked image of the Nintendo NX controller?
Yes. Wasn't it debunked horribly?
Yes. I would hope so, because it appeared to be modelled on Hey Arnold's head.
Oh. Well, I mean, that's a problem.
The problem with it is that it was believable because no one believes Nintendo can make just a normal controller. That's all. We only want a normal controller, and every time Nintendo's like, here's our new idea. It's two sticks you bang together. Like, stop it. Stop it, Nintendo.
Donkey Kong.
Samba de Amigo. Yay.
I just want a normal controller. I just want a normal console that's powerful and plays Nintendo games. That'd be great. That'd be so great.
That's not a controller. That's a blender charger. That's a base station for my blender. That's not... I don't believe that for a second. No. Absolutely not.
It looks like the shard of a mirror.
It does.
An evil mirror that predicts the future.
An evil mirror.
Yep. It must you complete like a shard.
Yes, we're how do I look, mirror? Fucking awful. Yeah. Don't pass slide.
Gather the six shards of Naruto.
Why did I buy this thing?
Gather the shards to play the Nintendo NX.
that's the logical step on from Skylanders and Amiibos.
Oh shit, you got
to
collect different controllers.
Parts of your console in mystery bags.
Man, that's almost like a PC. five bits
seven
of the console.
Graphics cards and no RAM.
God damn it. Why does this keep happening? It's another Titanex. Fuck.
These RNG boxes.
Only available in GameStop.
Oh, no!
My seven motherboards. For
you can't have a CPU because you didn't shop at Best Buy.
Yes. Oh, God. Yeah, you can't...
Gather them together for the ritual.
CPU coolers are a pre-order exclusive.
No! Yeah. Augment your pre-order.
Please never use that phrase again.
Don't worry, guys. It's still a console for children. We just need their blood in order to combine all the pieces together. So keep your kids around. We need virgin blood.
Yeah. Ultimately, it may very well be real, but who gives a fuck because the controller isn't out yet and neither is the console, so who gives a shit what it looks like?
No. And they already debunked, like, the other day when they said they weren't going to make any more Wii U's, Nintendo's already been like, no, we're still making Wii U's, so...
But people are like, well, Nikkei said it, and Nikkei's really reliable sometimes. Like, yes, okay, but Nintendo said no. Also, who cares? Are you an investor? No? Who cares? Who cares what the controller looks like? The console isn't going to be out for, like, months minimum. Why do you care?
If you look at the Wii U, there are six different controllers for that console.
Yep.
Literally six controllers.
I hadn't thought of that.
But... Yeah, you're right, yeah.
Bloody hell.
I have four of the six for that one console.
I have two.
And
so...
they're all different.
You know.
God, I never even thought of that. That is ridiculous, really, isn't it?
It's a bit silly.
They've got the newly branded GameCube one. They've got the new Pokken fighting controller. They've got like the Wii U black controller. They've got the regular one you come with.
But where's the shard of an evil mirror that looks like Hey Arnold's head?
It's in the new one.
Pre-orders! Pre-orders!
He's the support character for Pokken Tournament, is what he is. But no Psyduck! You get that, but no Psyduck. Disgusting.
There's a lot of weird sort of lies about Nintendo at the moment. We should make our own up.
Yeah! Let's come up with some rumors about Nintendo. Let's go around the room. Yeah. What do we got?
The Nintendo NX stands for non-existent and is just a scam to get your money with pre-orders.
Like Krispy Kreme, which was revealed today to be a hoax?
In fact, it is Krispy Kreme. Krispy Kreme
is a hoax.
Donuts are the Nintendo NX, guys.
But they're not donuts. They were a complete scam the entire time. We didn't realize the whole thing was a hoax. Go read that clickhole article. It's fucking hilarious. But so I heard after good old president's death, rest in peace. They decided they were going to develop a concept controller, which was basically a balloon, and you would control it by inflating and deflating the balloon. And this was all a big tribute to his seminal work, Balloon Fight. Which, unfortunately, they figured out that it was a little bit too lawsuit prone. It kept exploding in people's faces, so they had to cancel it. But
it was also shaped like a penis. That was a problem. They had a
That can happen. Like if it was blown incorrectly. And bear in mind, we all know Nintendo love games which let you blow on them. That's
incorrectly is a problem, guys. It's a huge problem.
You guys have no idea.
It's a huge problem.
How problematic that is.
Yep.
To blow incorrectly.
Blowing correctly is a huge problem.
I cannot stress enough.
Yeah,
the problem is you stress too much, and that's why you can't blow properly.
Correct.
More Nintendo rumors, please.
Apparently, the next amiibo to be released is going to be limited edition. You have to buy it directly from Nintendo stand at E3, and it features Tosh from The Bill.
You see, that's way too believable for me.
The Bill the police show?
Yeah. Tosh was the like balding guy with the moustache.
Oh, yeah, I remember him, yeah.
I mean, he's a iconic character, I would say. Iconic.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I must own it, so I shall go.
That's fair.
Is that why you're going to go to E3? I guess I got to go to E3 now. Oh, well.
What the fuck's Tosh at?
He's out of stock. But we do have this villager you can have.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Little Mac.
Little Mac. What is your Nintendo rumor strip before we move on and decide to leave the show for good?
My Nintendo rumor? Oh, I have to come up with a Nintendo rumor.
Oh, I'm sorry that I'm forcing you to be creative rather than relying on your dashing good looks for once.
Strippin is the best Pokken player in the world.
That's not believable.
Nintendo sent him a wreath of Mario plushies. By way of congratulations.
For his coffin? Is this an obituary? Like
what? For my... Because I'm the number one Pokken player in the world.
They sent you a wreath,
for
apparently.
Your funeral.
A wreath of Mario plushies.
Yep.
Yeah.
It may be Mario plushies, but it's still a wreath.
It's still a wreath. Most people don't get wreaths unless they're dead or remembering some ancient war.
Like, what about the bouquet of Mario plushies?
Yeah, there you go.
Okay. No. Or... Like a wreath.
No, not a wreath.
A festive wreath.
A basket.
Like they're dead and woven together. Like
a lunchbox of plushies.
What? No. like the ones that are like you hang them on the door.
No,
to ward away evil spirits.
What? It is true. It's on the news.
No, that was the Passover. That wasn't real. No.
It's in the Bible, guys.
You don't even have
Mario
a firstborn.
On your front door.
That was my Nintendo rumor.
Do you want some unleavened bread? Because I have it.
I'll give you some real news. ARC Survival Evolved are in a lawsuit.
Yeah, I heard about that.
Why?
Because they one of the guys who works for Dungeon Defenders was secretly fucking just making Survival Evolved on the side.
Yeah, it's an extremely basic non-compete.
Super rich off of it, and then they found out. I'm like, what the fuck, Bill? What are you doing? And he was like, oh, man, I know, this game sucked dick, so I just made a different one. And they were like, why are you doing this? And he was just like, look, now I'm rich. Fuck
disclaimer, y'all. We are not like, lawyers. Yeah, okay, cool.
Like, now we gonna take some of that money, because you've hurt our livelihood. And he's like, but your game's a shit tower defense, and mine's dinosaurs. And they're like, the games are the same, Bill. And you fucked this up for everyone, and now there's a lawsuit.
I'm not sure that that was a legally accurate interpretation
I'm
of
pretty
what
sure
happened.
It's somewhere he signed a contract that said, I'm not going to do anything like else.
Yeah, it's called a standard non-compete, which a lot of people have to sign. Yeah, that's what the issues are over. It's just over the non-compete. Like, it's actually a non-story as far as I'm concerned. Oh, it's a non-compete. That happens a lot. Okay, done. Next.
I guess the problem is that they're trying to sue Studio Wildcard as opposed to the actual guy, because they know how much money they've made. And they're trying to get money out of them.
Yeah.
So it's like one developer going for another developer because of one guy in the middle.
Yeah. Not great PR, because Trendy has had some PR issues in the past with possible
Dungeon
staffing
Defender
issues.
Sucks dick. So
okay, right. PR. I mean,
you must hate that game. I've never met anyone so passionately
against.
You've
gone hard on that game. Like,
no, that's the first. Just the first time I've ever said anything about it.
Yeah, and the first thing you said was adamantly like, fuck that game,
dude. I spent like fucking 7 hours trying to play co-op with a friend on Dungeon Defenders 2, only for them to be like, oh, sorry, we broke it and haven't fixed it for 4 days. You can't play with your friends. And I was just like, what? And they were like, you can play online, but just with strangers. Have fun. And I was like, all right, now I hate you forever.
Until the end of time. What a weird reason to hate people. You know what? I'm not going to judge you. I've hated Square Enix for less. I'm not going to judge you. You keep on hating, hater.
So hey, there was one final thing that actually has some significance, I think, which multiple confirmations of the rumors they may be, that there will be a PlayStation 4.5, which will be an upgraded version of the PlayStation 4.
What?
Yeah.
Oh, man, I'd hope that was some weird rumor, because it's...
I mean, it initially was, but there are more people now coming out of the woodwork and saying they've independently confirmed it. I believe Eurogamer Digital Foundry have confirmed it with their own sources after Kotaku basically said it. IGN has now followed up with it. So obviously it's possible that that's still wrong, but it looks like it's going to be an upgrade. The likelihood of it is that it will offer some sort of select 4K functionality. It will have increased processing power to actually get that, and it may also be smaller. I would also imagine they're making it probably future-proof it a little bit for VR, I would say.
Yeah,
it's probably quite likely.
That's going to be a major factor.
Yeah.
Is it called the 32X?
I hope it's not that mushroom ball sack looking thing. Oh, good lord. It looks
it's
like
a great console to collect for, though, because it's like 5 games.
Yeah, it's easy. You can get a complete collection. No problem at all. It looks like an infected sack of testicles, which is not ideal. But that was, yes.
That will be the shape of the NX controller, though. So.
An inflated sack of testicles, yeah. It's a derivative of the balloon controller that was ill-fated. Incidentally, those thinking it could play 4K, not a fucking chance. Not in a million years. They're talking about some kind of 4K output, probably for either some VR experience or either very, very, very limited game or for video as well, you know? Because 4K is incredibly demanding. If you've ever tried to run 4K, you will know exactly what I mean. Even on a system that has multiple high-end graphics cards, you're still going to be struggling. My system can play some games in 4K, but not at 60.
Yeah, someone's saying possibly just 4K for movies.
Most likely. Yeah. Yep, it's almost certainly just that. The upgrade is interesting, though, because it comes on the back of recent discussion and, not so much rumors, confirmation, that games like Quantum Break, which are obviously brand new for Xbox One, are actually running 720p under 30 frames per second and using magic, basically, to upscale to 1080p. a sort of some kind of temporal composition.
Dude, wasn't that like a big thing? They just lied to everyone, and then
yeah, they flat out lied. Yeah, I mean, it's the same with Killzone. You remember there was a lawsuit over Killzone when it first came out that said this game runs at 1080p, and actually half of it didn't. So they sued, which weirdly enough actually did not work. I would have thought it would have, but one way or the other, these consoles are really fucking underpowered. I don't know if you've noticed this, but they're already feeling really old after basically being out for 2 years.
Yep.
And
dude, Dark Souls 3 came out yesterday. It has frame rate issues on the PS4.
It has major frame rate issues on Xbox One and PlayStation 4.
Frame rate issues because the consoles can't handle the game.
It's that and the fact that all the Souls games have frame rate issues, all of them. You know, you remember Blighttown? Was there any reason?
I don't get frame rate issues now in Blighttown. I got frame rate issues then in Blighttown.
Well, I mean, if you got it on console, you still do, but on PC, you didn't.
That's true. You do on console. It's about 3 frames per second.
I mean, consoles they're already released out of date, and now they're even worse. You know, and why do you think I don't play anything? The only thing I play on is my Wii U because there are games that actually run at 60 on that.
My God, Pokken is clean at 60.
There you go.
Pokken is clean.
Why can the Wii U do this? Because that's what they prioritized. Instead of like, we want fancier shadows. It's like, well, I want a game that responds like it's not made of treacle. I would like that. That's why I have a PC.
I have a weird thing in my head I realized recently, whereas if I'm playing a game on console and the frame rate goes to shit, like Earth Defense Force, where, you know, fucking fall down to single digits. I don't care. It's fine. Playing it, don't mind. Oh, it just happens. If I'm playing a PC game and it dips below 60 frames per second for like 0.4 of a femtosecond, fist through the screen, I want to buy 9 new graphics cards now. I don't understand why I've got this weird disconnect.
You're just accepting of your failure of a son that is a console.
So it's a combination. Yeah. I think it's a combination of two things.
I expected better from you. All that money I spent on college. Damn.
I had piano lessons for nothing.
It's the kid that you know is going to be a failure, so you're not disappointed. So I'm going to give you a two-part explanation for why you think that and see if this is kind of close. Expectations, obviously. Yeah, that's the most obvious part of it. You don't expect it to be running really, really high frame rate, so you don't notice. The biggest part, though, secondly, it's the controller. The responsiveness of the controller, or the lack thereof, masks the changes in frame rate, whereas a keyboard and mouse is so quick, accurate, and basically instantaneous response that you immediately notice any drop in frame rate as a result.
A lot of PC games I do play on controller, though.
Okay, but you notice those too, right?
Yeah. I think what it is mostly for me is that in my head, the PC was a lot more expensive. Not only in my head, but also in my bank account.
Yeah, I was going to say that actually might be true.
The mothballs in my wallet.
So, yeah.
give me an unconscious level of this better fucking
the smoldering bank account.
Yeah,
Jesse,
yeah.
You've been like, your lighting is awful. You've been like black for the last hour. Like, you can't even see your face. It's just darkness, nothing but darkness.
You are Sith now.
Okay. There you go.
He's killed Han.
Best
I need your help,
part.
Father.
Hush.
That better?
Hush.
This redness?
Hush. So that's about it. Think PlayStation 4.5, maybe it will. I mean, I'm glad that they're even thinking about it, because if we're going to get another 7 years of this bullshit, then by the time we get to 2000 and... when they announce the PlayStation 5, games are going to be running at 3 frames per second. They're going to be fucking slideshows. So, no. Let's not. If you're going to do an upgradable console, or by upgradable mean buy a fucking new one, as in the Apple Mac syndrome, then cool. All right. I doubt it'll be enough of a performance upgrade to make a difference, but hey. Sure, why not? I'll just keep playing on PC. That sounds good. And that's it. I'm pretty much done. We've already overrun, so we're going to plug our stuff and leave. That's how it's going to be.
Sick.
So, Mr. Stuart Ashens, other than eating horrible food, what is it you do? Where can you be found? And how do you buy the terrible old games you probably never heard of book?
I didn't say other than. Say as well as, because people want to watch that. I want to watch that.
I know, and that makes me sad.
Thank you, Mr. Bain. I will live on the YouTube channel Ashens, Ashens. where we look at retro gaming stuff on occasion, really bad rip-off consoles, just crap I've bought from Poundland that isn't very good, and we point at it and laugh. And weird food, sometimes massively expired food. It's all a bit of a laugh. Go along, watch some videos, subscribe if you like, subscribe if you don't like. Don't subscribe if you like. Look, I don't care, I'm not your mother. Just sort yourself out.
So like, favorite, subscribe, box for box, sub for
that's,
sub.
Yeah, all that gubbins that I yes. don't get involved with generally.
And rightfully so.
Also, I have written a book. Terrible old games you've probably never heard of. We mentioned it at the start. Look at the lovely layout. I didn't do the layout. I'm bad with graphics. No. But unlike every other YouTuber in the world, pretty much, I did write the words myself.
Oh, so- shade. See this? This is shade. This is shade. I'm creating shade with your book.
I've got bullet holes from the shots fired.
Oh.
The audience knows. They always know.
I, if only that were true.
It's true of some of them.
Yes, thankfully.
John and Gwenda, if I remember. Anyway, yes, it's a nice book. You can order it from Amazon. It's very hard to get hold of if you're in America on the grounds it was only published in the UK. But
no,
you
it isn't.
Get Amazon to...
you don't even have to import it. Amazon currently has copies right now. I bought this yesterday and it arrived today. It was in stock and it wasn't even that expensive. It was like $12.
It's almost there like you're are. Trying to get rid of them.
Yes.
On clearance at this very moment. Yeah, it was easy.
Yeah, it's like, apparently like they've got local trying to stock get in America now. So.
They do. Someone must have imported it. It's actually $17, which is still cheaper than the recommended retail price. And it's on Amazon Prime. Yeah, you can just get it and it'll arrive like the day after or 2 days after, depending on where you are.
Also, you can buy our Blu-ray and DVD combo of the film What We Gone Done made a few years ago if you're in the UK.
Which is Ashens and the Quest for the Game Child.
It certainly is.
Correctly.
And we're currently working on a sequel, scripting at the moment for shooting later this year.
Congratulations.
Finished it. Thank you very much.
Do you feel okay making the rest of us look lazy?
Yeah, I'm kind of all right with that.
Good.
Yeah.
I'm glad you've come to
accept
that.
Someone has to be feeling good about the situation because we aren't.
Yes.
So
I'm already tired. Can I go back to bed? This is a lot of work.
I will confirm that Blu-ray is significantly cheaper than the Angry Video Game Nerd X Collection, which is $50 on Blu-ray.
Damn!
To be fair, that it does have a lot of stuff on it.
What? Yeah, so does Battleborn, and I can fucking buy that for $50.
Buy Battleborn, yeah. Not Angry Video Game Nerds Blu-ray.
Fuck you, game nerd! Battleborn! What a weird beef. Yeah, fuck the game nerd! It's all about Battleborn, you know?
Fuck the guy that laid the foundation for our entire careers! Fuck him! What a dick! Cock goblin!
Anyway, that's it, I think. Unless you live in Norwich in the UK, when next weekend I'm doing a talk about terrible old games at the Norwich Gaming Festival. So come along to that, if any of you are watching from there, and you're not. No.
People are requesting that I do the audiobook of this.
No, I'm going to do it myself. No.
There you go. Damn. Which is a much better idea.
And then, once he does it, you guys can get it on audible.com/cynical.
Cynical! There you go. Maybe.
Yep.
Maybe.
Yep. Nope.
Yep. He might not release it on
the entire
there.
Book now. We've got a minute, haven't we?
Yeah. Off you go. Cool. I'm gonna chill.
My God.
I gave up. That's his audiobook. Yeah. It's there.
It's a real.
It's pretty short.
Very short book.
Yeah.
I don't know if an audiobook would work really, because a lot of it's quite visual.
I think there's pictures, but I'd still listen to this shit.
You can describe it to people. Yeah.
There's a picture here. It's quite blocky. There's a man. He's white. He's standing near a black thing, and there's something brown, and yep. 8-bit graphics not quite working in that.
I mean, to be fair, this entire page is a fucking pigeon, and you could very easily tell people that.
True. There's a bad pigeon that looks like it was made out of origami by somebody whose hands don't work correctly.
Yeah. Yes. It also looks like it has a treasure map on it. I don't know if you've noticed that. There's a little trail with X.
That's the wing line. It does look a bit
like
that.
There's the fucking bad pigeon. That's the treasure map?
One of the worst games ever released commercially. It simply doesn't work and can't be played. And they released it commercially twice.
Man, anyone can just release a game. I should try and release a game.
You should.
I mean, you should have realized that. You've got Steam.
Cock Goblins,
The Reckoning.
Cock Goblins.
It's got to have The Reckoning in the title.
Yeah. Add Reckoning to anything, it just makes it instantly better.
Oh my God, you just steal cocks and while men are sleeping and they wake up and they're just like cockless. That's the game.
That is the worst idea for a
game. You are the worst.
I don't know how that would work.
Just this like, is a world where there's like a poop in my soup exists and you've somehow made a worse like a game than that.
That's how you beat the game. Everyone looks like Bobby and Ken.
Isn't that what happened with DOA Extreme 3 or 2? One of those where like the women, like they're all in their bikinis. They like have giant boobs and shit. But when they gave men bikinis, they had no dicks. It was just flat. And everyone was like, every man in this universe is a micro penis. Go look that shit up. It's really funny. It's great.
I did not hear about this at all, but okay.
Nope. I'll just a search, dead or alive micro penis, and now I'm on some sort of register. Thanks.
Look,
this happens every time Jesse's involved. I don't know why we haven't learned.
Get put on a registry at some point. It might as well be for micro penises and dead or alive.
Yeah, I searched penises, dead or alive, and I just got like Wild West stuff. Like what? Dick Clark? Dick Clark is dead.
Ooh, Dick Clark in a Wild Wild West movie called Dead or Alive about penises.
Dick Clark died. In 2012, apparently.
Rest
what does that have to do with dead or alive?
I typed in
the word dead.
And then it.
Gotcha.
Dick Clark is dead.
Shit.
Google, you are smart.
I'm just saying that they don't have any penises. That's all I'm saying. It's funny.
As its best friend and supporter, I'd like to give the obituary for our audible.com sponsorship, if you don't mind. It was a good man. It was a good sponsorship. It was taken before its time.
You tried so hard, but yeah.
It got so far, and in the end, it didn't even matter.
Will you remember me?
In the arms of an angel.
Slowly turn the light off.
Let's go. It's time to go home. Turn it off. Shut it down. We're
you
done.
Shower of bastards. Oh, fuck me. Jesse, what's coming up on your channel this week?
I literally have no clue. I just figured out a new Let's Play to make. I got so caught up in Oxenfree. I haven't done much besides that in my life. So something else new is coming. Fan Friday. Oh, CoxCon on Friday. I opened up 300 more tickets because I wanted to because people were pestering me.
Because you like money?
All these people pestered me and there's still 200 left. Look. You sons of bitches. I shouldn't have done it. We were sold out, and you bastards made it. So we're changing it again. Look, it's happening.
You're taking 200 back.
I'm going to take it back if you don't buy them. I'm just going to take them back. Effias. I got so many harassing
sold
people.
Out again.
Like, I wanted to go in here, and they were sold out before I could go, and I really wanted to see Totalbiscuit. And I thought it would be... I'm going to take them away now. Asshole, take it away. You better buy them.
Do I not have to go now?
Remove them.
Fuck.
That's good because I don't have to buy Strip's Carvery dinner.
Oh, fucking hell.
You're not going to get one. You're going to have to buy your own.
I've got to buy both of us now after what happened.
Yeah, you do. Paragon. You absolutely do. You're responsible for that. There's a harvester. We can go with that.
You win some, you lose some, I guess.
But I'm not gonna get it for you. You have to get it yourself.
Fucking hell. That's £5. That's £5 there.
Fuck. Strip, what the hell's coming up on your channel? Oh wait, you barely have one.
Oh,
do you have you have a Twitch though?
Yeah, not a lot's been going on. I've been having some personal issues this week. So we haven't done much content, but I will be streaming later today. I'm gonna be playing some Pokken tournament right after this. I'll probably stream that through to the weekend. I'm not gonna stream Dark Souls yet, I'm gonna wait. Until like April 7th or something.
That's oddly
specific.
The NDA lifts April 8th, and that means I can actually play the whole game without having to... Like, these guys will have to play a third of the game, then wait 2 weeks. Why the fuck?
Unless they have the Japanese version and are not bound by the embargo as a result.
Yeah, which is like one guy that can speak Japanese on Twitch.
Yes.
And he's making bank right now.
Or you ended up getting the version on Xbox that converted to English and you were also not bound by an embargo agreement. So those of us that actually got the press version are literally handicapped versus those that didn't.
They were like, congratulations, here's your early copy and some handcuffs. Fuck you.
Which is hilarious. Cool. Which is also why I will not endure any more of your complaining. It's like, you don't get it. We got fucked.
At youtube.com/strippin, twitch.tv/strippin, and at strippin on Twitter.
Consistent branding, we like it. What's going on with the channel for me? I will hopefully finally get back into it. I've been taking a few days off because doctor's orders and fatigue and shit. But now, thanks to kale, I am back on my feet. So I am go-
Wonder food.
Fucking kale.
Kale the food, or like a nurse called Kale?
No. Kale the food.
A nurse called Kale. That's a good book. Aw, yeah. That's a good book.
It's a kind of manga, right?
Nurse called Kale.
Yeah. Battleborn video. I'll be doing a video telling you why you're all stupid and you should actually look at Battleborn because you don't know what the hell you're talking about. I'll probably do a Paragon video, which will say you're all stupid because you're supporting the card system, which is awful. I'll do a Battlefleet Gothic video in which I'm just going to make orc noises for 20 minutes and you're going to love it.
Can I just interject really quick? I finally saw the Battlefleet Gothic orc video.
It's so fucking good!
I don't know what the hell any of them said. It is 2.5 minutes of orcs going, roar, roar, roar. I'm like, I have no
idea
what
it's the most British thing that exists. It's, look, Warhammer 40,000 is a national British treasure. Games Workshop, a terrible company that it is, has produced things that we are proud of for some reason. And orcs are the most British of the British. Everyone in the 40K universe is British. Orcs are extra British.
I could not understand a word that was said in that trailer. It was unintelligible. I was like, I don't know what's happening.
It is the voices
in Dawn of War are still some of my favorite things ever. Let's make it orky. Fix your gubbins.
Yeah.
They're like the people I grew up with, except less ugly.
They're like my dad. But green.
Yeah, to fix your gubbins.
Yeah.
It's like a mixture of a angry bear and Smeagol, but it works. And now they have spaceships. Who thought that was a good idea? I don't know, but they're flying in spaceships. The trailer came out 2 hours ago, and it's the most British fucking thing in the universe. I'm going to play it at the end of the show.
Go watch it.
It's just too
Please
good.
Please, someone tell me what they say. Someone write to me what is
just
being
translated.
I can translate it for you. Don't worry.
I don't know what the hell they're talking about.
I hope one of those from Glasgow. That'll be great. Yeah, that's a thing. There'll be videos, probably. Otherwise, I'm releasing a t-shirt either today or tomorrow.
Ooh!
Into the wild.
Into the wild, yes. You need a freezer if you're going to hunt it down. Get your motors.
He's been rehabbing this t-shirt.
If you're out hunting motors and you happen to see the t-shirt fly by,
grab it. Yeah, just pop it and you get 400 points. It's based on, it's a parody of Deadpool. You will hopefully like it, and I'll probably be releasing it either tonight or tomorrow morning. I'm also going to immediately go and work on uploading this podcast because I accidentally said the podcast will be up Thursday and then realized Ashens had to delay, so I have a deadline which has already passed. So, sorry, Audible, I'm getting it done now. Please don't leave us, regardless of all of this. But regardless, big thanks to Ashens for coming on the show today. You've been a wonderful guest.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. Very good of you.
Definitely a dream invite for a lot of people over the last few years. We will happily have you back anytime if you can stomach our bullshit.
I'm sure that can be arranged.
Wonderful.
And
ladies and gentlemen.
Goblins.
Indeed. Yeah, Thank you very much.
At least 3 more cock goblins next time.
That can be arranged. We will get them shipped and packaged. I believe we have to freeze dry them for long distance, but it should be okay. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been the Questionable Podcast. Thank you very much for watching. Big thanks to our sponsor, audible.com/cynical today. And big thank you to Strippin for filling in for Dodger, who is lazy. We will be seeing you probably next week at some point, maybe. I don't even have a guess for next week. I'll figure it out. Thanks. Bye.
Condor.
No.